Frank left his gavel behind.
Good evening. The regular school board meeting for May is in session. First item is superintendent.
Thank you very much. I'd like to turn this over to Loretta Pond for a few minutes. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Dr. Pelletier. Tonight is Harold Patius's final school board meeting, and I wanted to say a few words about Harold. There are many things about Harold Patius that we're going to miss when he leaves this school board after 6 years of service. We'll miss hearing him say, and he said it often, "Now I'm no educator," and then proceed to quote educational studies, statistics, and conversations he's had with educators. He was always convincing and informed, and he shaped policies that have made this a better school system. We'll miss the sense of history that he brought to the school board. Harold grew up here and attended Cape schools, and he could always fill us in on the way things were in the olden days. It was helpful to know why the halls were built so wide at the high school, or why the baseball field really needed to be fenced. Since he received a very good education here, I'm surprised that he didn't sometimes say, "It was good enough for me, so it should be good enough for these kids today." I never once heard him say that. He was a progressive in his ideas about education. We'll miss his late arrivals at workshops and meetings. It was not uncommon for Harold to arrive 10 to 20 minutes late, either straight from a plane from Washington, D.C. that had been delayed, or having driven in the fog from somewhere in northern Maine. He would run in, not having had any dinner, and usually say, "Let's try to get this done by 9 o'clock. I haven't been home." Then at 11 o'clock, he was still there grappling with issues which needed to be resolved. He gave a lot of time, a lot of quality time to this job. Most of all, we'll miss his advocacy for all school children in Cape Elizabeth. Even when we have disagreed on policies and issues, I have always known him to be consistent in his ideas of what he believed that good education was and what is best for kids. He has worked to make this school system among the best, if not the best, in Maine, and has accomplished this through his work on the career ladder, hiring new, extremely qualified administrators, and endorsing school programs that have strengthened the CAPE educational system. This board will miss Harold. So will the community. So will the school system. He has been a good friend to education. And now, as a small token of our appreciation, we'd like to present you with this plaque, Harold.
Thank you very much, Loretta. I appreciate that, and thank you all. I'd just like to say that I'll be 53 years old this summer, and I've had at least two distinct careers, one in government and one in the law. And I've done a lot of things along the way, and I have never been engaged in any activity or any endeavor, either in my profession, practicing law here in Maine, in government in Washington, or in a variety of political activities around the country that I have enjoyed as much as this one. I think of all the things I've ever done, all the places and people that I've been associated with, this has been the most fun for me. As you all know, I have worked very hard to avoid controversy. I have tried to not to reveal in any way my own personal opinions. And I have not succeeded.
Peter?
Harold, we have one more small token of our appreciation. And it really harkens back to something that makes you a unique member of this school board, and that is the fact that you grew up in this town. The four of us remaining board members who have who are sitting up here this evening have lived in this town precisely half as long as your 53 years. I thought it was 52. I thought you were my age.
I am, but I'm going to have a birthday this summer.
Okay. Mine will be shortly thereafter. One of our favorite stories, or mine anyway, of the olden days, as Loretta called them, was when we were discussing our recreational facilities, and you recall that when you were in school here, that you just brought along a ball, and that's what everybody played with. So we think that that institutional memory of how things were in the olden days is important to this town, and as a symbol of that, we have autographed this baseball for you. But you could put it on your shelf alongside that elegant plaque.
Oh, that's terrific.
It's a token of our appreciation and thanks on behalf of all the town for your service to the school board.
Thank you. Thank you. That's very nice. Thank you all again. And I just wanted to add that it's been a pleasure working with all of the administrators and all of the teachers in the school system and the people who come to these meetings. We have first-class administrators, first-class teachers, and the people of Cape Elizabeth I have discovered over the last 6 years, and I didn't know it because I wasn't involved with the school system before, are really blessed with the people that we have who work to make Cape Elizabeth the very best system in the state of Maine. Well, Mr. Superintendent, we move on to your report and the comments by high school representatives.
All right. Are they here this evening?
Okay, first of all, I just want to run down for you some of the traditional end-of-the-year activities that are going to be going on at the high school. First of all, this year's junior-senior prom will be held on May 25th at the Portland Club. This is traditionally held every May for the juniors and seniors. And also graduation and the senior class trip to the thing seniors, I'm sure, look forward to, will be held graduation June 16th. and the class trip about 10 days before that on June 6th. Now, I'm not sure what the seniors are planning to do this year, but some of the ideas that have been popular in the past have been canoeing, whitewater rafting along the Saco River. Things like that have been very successful. The students, the seniors will be let out of school for one day and will take a trip. Also, there will be an evening of excellence on May 18th. Now, this is put on by the Community Services Program. And what it is basically is a big potluck dinner that's held in the cafeteria. And all the honor students from the high school are invited, and they have a dinner. Awards are handed out, and then everybody will go into the auditorium for the inductions for the qualifying students for the National Honor Society and also for the Maroon Medal Society. So it's really a night that the students and the administration had the opportunity to celebrate some of the accomplishments of the students, which is really nice to have. Also on June 1st, the last musical concert for the band, the chorus, and the jazz band will be given in the high school auditorium. This will be held at 7:30 on June 1st. And lastly, class day, which is another traditional meeting, which will be held on June 15th, the day before graduation. Bigger awards are given out, I guess you could say, such as college book awards to juniors who will be becoming seniors next year, awards for academic endeavors for the students of all the classes, and just a general gathering in the auditorium for a few last words. The seniors will also march, since it's the day before their graduation. They will march in their cap and gowns, so it will be a good day. Also, just a few comments. There was a lot of concern. We had a dance on St. Patrick's Day, and I know that there was a lot of concern with the parents' organization enough for Mr. Miles to send home letters and for the parents' forum to be notified and a big discussion held on this. So Mr. Miles took the problem to the student council just about a month and a half ago. And instead of just taking the problem just as student drinking, the problem was that there was too much student alcohol consumption at this dance, in the opinion of the administrators and the students. Now, instead of just going and tackling this, such as we don't want student drinking, just saying that, we decided that we should probably go to the roots of the problems and take different facets of the problems one at a time. And what we decided to concentrate on was the issue right now that we felt was the most dangerous, and that was how the students were getting there and how the students were getting home, and in particular, driving under the influence. So what the student government and Mr. Miles set up was a seminar that we had last Friday for the whole school. We had a speaker from, two speakers actually, from Mothers Against Drunk Driving, who gave a very informative seminar and really fulfilled our goal that was not to have just a lecture, but to have an informative presentation with question and answer sessions after. So I think that this was very beneficial, and we're continuing to chip away at this problem, among others, with the student council. We'll be having elections within next month for next year's student council. So we'll be forming that for next year. Thank you.
Any questions?
We'll have a short report on the Homestay Committee, and I'll ask Peter Leslie to make that.
The Homestay Committee met again last evening, and Don Sanborn said that the handbook for prospective homestay parents is almost ready. It was also reported that we found homes for two Spanish students, girls. We're still looking for a home for one Mexican boy, and we have found a home for one Norwegian boy. The recent publicity in the Cape Courier and other sources have led us also to several other prospects for homestay parents, but we are always on the lookout, and we're trying to spread the word that that is the keystone of the arch for the homestay program. There will be some announcements on the high school intercom, and so to those of you who are out here this evening or listening, if you're interested, please let one of us know, and if you know of anybody else who might be, please help spread the word. That is the report for this evening.
Thank you.
Any questions?
Mr. Chairman, item C is very up-to-date preliminary report on college acceptance, and I just want to compliment the seniors for another, what I would call, banner year, and we will give you an update in 2 weeks when they are all in. There are a number of youngsters who are, at this point, not prepared to say where they're going, or we're still waiting for certain acceptances. But I'm extremely pleased with the list, and I want the board to get an opportunity to see it in May. The next time you see it will be for graduation, and it'll be as up to date as we can make it.
Any questions about the list?
All right, if there are no questions, I'd like to go to the next item. We promised the board that we would give you a report on the progress of the 8-period day or 7-period day. And you have a memo, May 3rd, from Frank Miles. And I would ask Frank if he to please come to the podium in the event there are some questions. It appears to me that this was a wise decision in terms of the advantages of the 8-period day, and I'd forgotten that graduation requirements had increased almost 30-fold since the legislation of 84. Mr. Miles, would you like to say a few words about this?
I hope that my comments in this memo were fairly clear. We appointed a committee last fall of both students and teachers to look at the whole issue of how the high school might best be scheduled. Last summer, when we had to accommodate the schedule to the increase in time, we had already scheduled the school and had a students in classes, and we had to find a way to somehow insert the extra time mandated by the board into the school schedule. We did that by trying to solve a problem with science lab conflicts with other courses. We created a 70-minute period, which rotated through our schedule in the first semester. In the second semester, we found it much better to have it fixed in one location, and we rotated the periods around that. But in any case, 5 of the 7 periods had the advantage of having one block of 70 minutes each week. This was very advantageous for science labs, for art, industrial technology, physical education, and in some other subject areas as well. But it was not uniformly successful, I think, in other academic subjects, and I think students did not always find it uniformly successful. Since we had taken the measure as a temporary means of making use of the additional 30 minutes, we appointed a committee in the fall to begin looking at different ways of scheduling the school. And one of the key problems for students in the school is to find time to schedule electives, and others to find time for science labs. We knew that if we borrowed time from some other parts of the current school schedule, namely that 70-minute period and homeroom and some of the passing time, which is very nice to have 5 minutes between class, but most schools do with 3 or 4 minutes, and next year we will also go with 4 minutes. We found that we could add a period to the day, and that accomplishes several things. It does allow us, we think, to schedule science labs satisfactorily. Not as easily as the current 70-minute period, to be sure, because that is virtually absolutely conflict-free, and that's the beauty of that 70-minute period. But it doesn't, an 8-period day will allow us, I think, to do it satisfactorily, and it will give us much more time to, give students more time to take electives, which sometimes they now have trouble doing. In freshman year and in parts of the junior year, students must take 6 courses out of 7 periods. It becomes tight. It becomes very difficult in a school that's as small as our high school to make a master schedule that works. Most of our classes are what are called singletons or doubletons. There's only one or two sections of that class. And that creates, in a 7-period day, a lot of conflicts. And finally, we have 21 courses actually at this school required for graduation. That is, there are 21 credits for graduation. In the way our high school counts, it's 210 credits. But if you divide the credits by 10, because each course that's a year long is a 10-credit course, it's 21 courses. And those are rather specific. So when the graduation requirements went up from 17 to 21, this schedule did not expand correspondingly. So what we have done is come up with a schedule for next year that is an 8-period day. It does not have a homeroom. Many schools do not have homerooms, and I think they operate very successfully. Some schools have had them and gone back to them, and others have operated happily without them, and I think it'll be a new experience, I think, for our high school, but I think one that will work. There are 4 periods in the first half of the day, and the periods in the first part of the day will rotate through many of those periods. The exception being the second class period of the day will always be the same, and it's that period that we will use to, in a sense, take consistent school attendance. There's, in a sense, a small break for announcements at 10:30. That will also be the time that our students who go to PRVTC will be able to leave the school, having met the needs that they have at Cape High School, and their program at PRVTC starts at, I think, 11:10. So they will get on a bus and go to the Regional Vocational Training Center. And then we start, in a sense, a 4-period segment in the afternoon. Our lunch will be at almost the same time that it is this year, from 11:18 to 11:40, and again from 12 o'clock to roughly 12:20. And then we will have our usual last 2 periods of the day, and school will close as usual at 1:55. We have built a master schedule and are in the process of running some simulations of that schedule with a computer. There will be an arena day that's traditionally been held at the high school. It will be Friday. I think it's May 26th. I may be off a day. It may be the 5th. I can't remember which day it is without a calendar. But it will be the Friday before the Memorial Day weekend. And we are optimistic that the schedule will work well and students will have more flexibility in it. And I think many of our students already take 6 and some 7 courses, and I think this will allow them to take the electives that they would like to take. We are not going to encourage them to take, we don't want them to overload themselves, I guess that's the way to put it. And so I think we will caution students if we think they are doing that. But many students seem to make up their minds very satisfactorily for themselves and make a challenging schedule for them.
Any questions of Frank?
I have several questions. In a 7-period, if we were having a 7-period day next year,
right? Just like this one, or
Let's say you'd added 4 minutes to each period.
Okay.
And so you didn't have the 70-minute period, but you had a seven-period day.
Right.
So that's what we now have. We're going to an 8-period day.
Right.
All right. The electives are things like art and music. I mean, these are electives.
The fine arts, industrial technology, as well as
theater.
But there are, students
also. All right. Are those classes full? I mean, are there enough students in those classes now that they're fairly filled?
Are those classes full?
Yes.
I don't think, in some cases they are, yes. In other cases they aren't. I can't give you a blanket answer. In art, for example, this year they're full. They're over full. Next year, they're, I think, full would be accurate too, given that we've encouraged students, told students there would be more art courses available. Industrial technology courses, Some are full and some aren't, but that's not a change from the past. Whether it's a seven, it's about the same kind of enrollments as we've had in the past.
Well, my question is, next year, if you go to an eight-period day, those teachers aren't going to teach an extra period, correct? They'll still be teaching five periods just as they are this year.
That's correct.
But now the students have so many more choices of that extra period times, you know, that they can have some of these electives. Is there going to be room for them in these electives that we're making a period for, or is it just going to be more study halls?
Yes, no. Well, we do not anticipate more study halls. And I think what we expect is that students will find room in those courses and will take advantage of those. I am optimistic about it. I can't guarantee that, you know, they're going to all be absolutely full. I would hope that there is room for students to expand it, and there certainly is at the moment, particularly in the industrial technology courses. Some of the academic electives are subscribed. It's hard for me to give you a categorical answer because we don't have hard and fast schedules. Students have, in a sense, given a tentative list of what they'd like to take. I will be able to answer that in much greater detail in June when we've had the arena day and have some course tallies that are really very firm.
Because I anticipate perhaps students wanting some of these classes, having the time for these classes, and next year you saying we need this teacher and we need that teacher, and that's not my sentiment. I'm still really more toward stressing the basics and trying to keep our strength in those subject areas, although I understand that we're not taking any time from the schedule.
That's correct. There's, you know, one of the things that we also are going to need to address with some students next year, and as we have this year, but we hope to do it in a more successful way next year with some space to do it, is the computer requirement that we have had much better use of our computer facility this spring. We are going to try to encourage juniors and seniors to take advantage of that opportunity to and arrange for them to do so. So I think that there are some ways that people will be encouraged to use some time, because we do not particularly want them to be, we want them to use their time as wisely as possible, let's put it that way, and take advantage of the facilities in the school. And I think students, by and large, do quite a good job of that. The students, in fact, come in and ask for as many courses as they can, I think, frequently, because they also want to use the facilities of the school and do not want a lot of extra time. I don't get the sense that there will be. We looked at some other schools that have eight-period days, and they do not seem to find that there are problems of students having time on their hands that is a burden for them. And I think we believe this is the best thing for us to do at the moment, and have looked pretty carefully at some options. And I think we would have some severe problems trying to get all this into a seven-period day.
What is homeroom used for at this time?
It is a period in which we can make some announcements. We take attendance. There are some class activities that occur there, and I think it is a moment in the day when students can try to rev up their engines, if you will.
Is that going to happen during first period now?
Shouldn't. I've worked in schools that have not had homerooms, as well as schools that have had homerooms. I don't think that once the transition is made, students have a great deal of problem. They get the first period.
Announcements won't be made during first period.
No, they will not be. No, announcements are going to be made at 10:30 in the morning or the day.
And one more question.
Sure.
And that is, now where are we with the science labs? Now that we don't have the 70-minute period, are we back to on the day that you have science lab, you miss a course, or you? It's only one day a week. Then do they have 4 days of study hall?
They have 4 days of study hall or free time, or they have gym class, or they have time to work in open labs or schedule. One of the things we're going to try to do is develop some computer courses that will fit around that, those kinds of flexible times. But yes, one period in the day of a student's eight periods would probably be a lab period. And that is a traditional way that high schools schedule labs. They schedule them back-to-back with a class. I mean, that's fairly standard practice in most high schools.
You know what was happening at our high school? which was they were taking a five-period class and also having lab at the same period.
Right.
And then missing one or the other.
We are going to discourage that, and we really believe we will not have many instances of that. And I really can't say more than that, because I really believe Mrs. Merrill and I have looked at the schedule and believe we have the space to do that. If that turns out not to be the case, then we've miscalculated, but we don't think it's going to be nearly the conflict. One of the problems in a seven, we have more options to try to schedule that conflict free within 8 periods. And we're banking on that. Many other schools do that. I think I would be less than candid to say that schools don't have some conflicts, but generally what they do is they resolve those conflicts by hand scheduling students to try to avoid those conflicts in those courses. And I think we're, in some cases, we'll see. And we will try to break those conflicts on an individual basis.
That sounds like 2 years ago.
Well, I don't know what 2 years ago was like, but I just...
You know, a lot of customized scheduling to try to fit it in, and teachers saying, I'll give up them this period, but you've got to give them to me next.
We're not running into that in the initial run through the computer. That is, we're not running into large numbers. I think the numbers were 70 and 80 2 years ago. I may have the numbers wrong. It may have been 20. I don't know, but I recall a higher number, and I don't think we're getting those kinds of numbers now, so we're much more optimistic.
Thank you.
Other people have questions. I think this is a very important discussion. This is part of the superintendent's report, and I think we've got to respond to the superintendent and tell him whether we're satisfied with this approach or whether we want a different approach. We've had a little difficulty on using the extra time last year. What happened was we had to report on how the time would be used. And I guess we didn't ask enough questions, because after it went into practice, we were disturbed by what was occurring. So I want to be in a position to, and that's why I appreciated your questions, to say, look, Mr. Superintendent, Mr. Principal, we're satisfied that this is the best way for it to work next year, or we're not satisfied, and we'd like you to come back to the school board with some adjustment in this thing, and let us take a look at the adjustment. I think Loretta knows more about the high school schedule than the rest of us, because she's had personal experience with it. Not that she just graduated from high school, but she does know a lot about it. Are there any other questions? Or what do you think?
I was really satisfied with the answers. If each class period had just been 1 minute shorter, I would have not liked that, because I really don't like us taking time away from the solid basic subjects that all high school students need. But it seems like you've managed to keep every class period exactly at the time that it's been in the past. And I'm very satisfied with your answers. And I think, you know, we're not saying we're adopting this for life, but I think a year of giving it a try is certainly reasonable from my standpoint.
And I think that if it turns out that this does not work as well as we anticipate, and we cannot tune it in a sense, we've made some adjustments, for example, in the current schedule at mid-year, which I think have improved that, but nonetheless, the 70-minute period still remains problematic. It solves the science labs perfectly. There's no better way to solve a science lab problem than the 70-minute period. It's just absolutely foolproof. There's no doubt about that. Science teachers love it, but the other teachers do not, and nor do all the students in all the other classes. So I think that it's not rave reviews, I think, on any schedule, and I think my experience with probably about 5 or 6 different high school schedule formats has been they all have their strengths and weaknesses, and you sort of have to decide what you want to make your compromises on. So we're going to try it if it goes planned.
Mr. Chairman, I'm very optimistic. I've read everything the teachers discussed on this, and I'm optimistic that a number of things can happen. Number one,
I would hope that we could double the library use in the school, and this will be an opportunity. I've discussed with the principal his interest in study skills, which hopefully can be developed, which will be time, we'll have time for. And here's an opportunity for our youngsters to get a number of electives. I think we'll give you a report in 6 months to see how this is working, just the way we gave you a report last year on the new change. But I'm optimistic that this may be the way to go, and to start doing a number of other things where youngsters can use the time responsibly.
Well, any other comments? Daryl, what I understand here now is that there is a consensus of the school board on this. Everybody agree? There is a five of us, I guess. Our response to you is that we're satisfied with this proposal for utilization of the extra time in the high school.
Shall I go on to the next item?
I just want the minutes to reflect that.
Thank you. I would just like to report for information, basically, that today and tomorrow we're going through what is called a comprehensive site review. This is a result of the Educational Reform Act of 1984. There are three consultants from the State Department that are going through just about everything we're doing, from facilities to curriculum. And it's a follow-up on the school improvement program that was written some 3 years ago. And tomorrow is our last day. They will leave us and return and give us a report. And we'll come back again in 5 years. This is a mandate from the state. Each 5 years, there'll be a complete comprehensive review. It's called the site review. And it's involved teachers, the administrative council, and even young people. So I'll be able to give you a report, their report. I don't anticipate until September. But in the event somebody stops you and asks you some questions, and if they have a badge or something, you'll know who they are and why they're here. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to go right to the next report.
All right.
I'd like to put this report in perspective. This is called the Gifted and Talented Report. More than a year and a half ago, we presented to the board a five-year Gifted and Talented Report that went to the state. I did some checking today, and I believe this was done in a workshop with three of the present board members and two of the board members who are no longer with us. And if I'm wrong, please correct me in terms of time.
I'm not sure it was 1.5 years ago. I think it was last year. And I believe, wasn't it in this room?
Yes. Was in this room.
It was in this room. It was last year, and it was we discussed the five-year plan that was going to be sent to the state. We asked a lot of questions. We got the responses, so forth.
And in that report, it was sent to the state, and it was accepted by them. As part of that report was a K-8 progress report on the program presently in use, and that started some time ago by a committee called the Challenge Review Team. And Mr. Toy and Wayne Doerr, and I think maybe most of his committee is here, but I'll turn this over to Chris.
Can I ask you one question before you do that? What is the relationship between the charge given to this committee and the five-year plan? Five-year plan went in.
Five-year plan indicated that there would be, in this year, a report of the challenge, from a challenge committee, of how we're operating K through 8. That was one of the mandates, several mandates, but that was one of them. And here it is. The report has been completed.
Okay, but I not questioning that, but the report has recommendations. It is recommending to the board certain things. So it's not simply an analysis of let us give you a picture of what of what's going on here. It is we have analyzed what is going on here, and here's what we're recommending.
Well, I'm not certain it's that. One of the things is we've analyzed what's going on. Here are some of our findings, and there's another meeting next Tuesday, I believe. So
I think we're talking about two different committees. I think the committee that you're speaking about was the big committee that Mary Jo Thompson headed in Wayne Door and met for a couple of years. The committee that's here tonight is one, a smaller one that's met only for this past year.
No, I'm not, I'm differentiating between the two. But what I'm saying, in the five-year plan that was done some time ago, one of the prerequisites or one of the things that that called for was a review of the challenge program K through 8. And this is a report of what they have done, that committee.
Let me settle the argument by reading their an excerpt from their report, which is written in very good plain English so we can all understand.
Go ahead.
Okay. Let me read. The discussion has been, what is this committee's charge? And so I'm going to just read an excerpt or two from the report, which tells us how they viewed their charge, because it tells us why they're giving us the report.
Okay.
They say the committee has been meeting approximately twice a month to discuss various issues surrounding the challenge program. I'm just excerpting, not reading everything. It is significant that many of the issues, and we're talking about issues, Mr. Superintendent, that are being discussed by the committee or that have been discussed by the committee are the very same issues that are currently being debated nationally. Okay, so we're talking about issues here. And the Cape Elizabeth is in the forefront of the national discussion. Beyond looking at our own, what's been going on in our program over the past several years, this says that the committee reviewed a great deal of current literature related to programming of gifted and talented, consulted with the Maine Department of Education, administered surveys to parents or sent out surveys to parents, and then identified, the committee identified the central issues, two or three central issues that surfaced as the result of this process. And those central issues are the nature of pull-out programming, two, identification of students for differentiated instruction, and three, the structure of programming for able learners. Finally, after going through this process and identifying those to be the critical issues, the committee made recommendations. These are not all the recommendations they're going to make, but these are some of the recommendations that they have settled on to date. The reason that they have not completed their work and made recommendations on all of the things that they might make recommendations on is that the committee has not reached a consensus on these items. And maybe we'll find out whether that means the committee has not reached a consensus on those items that we do not find in the recommendation list, or maybe it means that even with those items on the recommendation list, there may be the lack of, there's a list of 13 recommendations, and the ones with stars mean what?
That there's not a consensus.
All right, so we have 13 recommendations. How many stars?
Three.
Three stars. Okay. This is a little bit more in a review.
That was excellently done, and it's probably most of Mr. Toy's report. What I wanted to make very clear was the sentence that you missed. One of the activities designated...
Well, wait a minute. I may have missed it on purpose, Darrell.
Well, I know, but...
Go ahead.
Knowing we always agree, I'm sure you'll agree to allow me to read it. This is only one portion of our five-year plan. One of the activities designated for initiation during the 88-89 school year was a review of the challenge program at our middle school. Now, I wouldn't want people to think that that's the only part of the five-year program. And the chairman has very clearly made Mr. Toy's report, and now he may want to complete it.
Let me just make a comment here, interject. It has nothing to do with this subject, but I sense we're all beginning to shout up here, and I'd like to point out to the people in the back of the room that there are at least 10 empty chairs up here in the front. So I urge you to come forward, because we probably won't keep shouting for the full hour of this meeting.
Darrell, before I begin, do you have a copy of the five-year plan here? Because I certainly haven't memorized it.
Okay. Can I get it for you?
Yeah. I'd like to be able to refer to that.
Wayne, could I have the five-year plan, please? Mr. Toy.
Thank you. It should be obvious to everyone that the challenge review team needs to be commended for all the work that it did, as pointed out by the chairman. I would also add that the surveys are available to the board to look at if they so desire. I would also add another note, and that is that Judy Malcolm, who is the Department of Education consultant for gifted and talented programs, is a member of the review team that's here. And she did have an opportunity to look over our recommendations while she was here. And she seemed to feel that they were good recommendations in terms of gifted and talented programming. And a reasonable way to proceed at this point. I would also reiterate, Mr. Patius said, this is a progress report, and that is because we have not settled all of the issues, and it's significant to note that many of these issues that we are talking about, not just these three, are not settled nationally or even within New England or the state. So on that, the recommendations do touch on some very specific areas. As a result of our surveys and discussions among ourselves, we found that it is an extremely important point that the school provide consistently high expectations for all of its students. That was one major finding, which you will find in the recommendations, essentially recommendation number one, which says that the school ensure that a consistently strong classroom curriculum be taught to all students. We felt that that needs to be the basis from which all instruction begins, from a strong fundamental program for all students. We also found out from our surveys that just about all people felt that there were aspects of the challenge program from which all students could benefit. And the conclusion that we reached on that particular item was that we need to look at expanding the services that we provide to students. in terms of critical thinking, problem solving, the writing process, things like that. In addition to the arts, which were mentioned by several people. Another item that we had to deal with, and it was towards the end of our work, and that was the realization, as the budget process continued, that we needed to look at a new organization. In other words, the school system at the elementary and middle school level would be restructuring under a K-5 elementary program and a 6-8 middle school program. At this point, the 4-5 program being in the middle school, if the restructuring were also, and it is a curriculum restructuring, we needed to begin to look at what the programming would look like K-5. So that is the reason that we have the recommendation that the director of curriculum be involved, so that we are sure that there is coordination for the new restructuring, so that we don't end up with, you know, 3 or 4 different programs just within the elementary and middle school structures. We also determined that we had to take a close look at the selection process, what we put the kids through, what we try to identify, a feeling from the members of the committee and also from the parents and the students that answer the surveys, that in some instances we do not identify all types of giftedness. That we tend to, the process as it looks now, looks at global giftedness, but not necessarily, as we've mentioned, the artistic giftedness, or perhaps a student would be gifted or highly able in one area, say mathematics, but not necessarily in language arts, or maybe very good in science or have proficiency in social studies. So we needed to look at the selection process as well. In addition to that, the recommendations also deal with staff development. And that is that if we were going to be looking at expanding services to all students and challenging all students in each of the areas, that teachers in the classroom would have to have the skills, the knowledge, the ability to provide those kinds of services. In other words, it should not be incumbent on just one or two people to provide the totality of those services. In addition, there are some budget implications in terms of staffing, as I mentioned, training. And probably the final part of that is the issue of how do we go about orchestrating reasonable, measured, effective change. There were, and I'm sure there were, a lot of concerns about the proverbial throwing the baby out with the bathwater on one end, and on the other end, change not being effectively carried out soon enough in light of what we already know about kids and learning. I'd like to turn for a minute to the 3 areas in which we are not in agreement, in total agreement. And I think it's really a matter of what the implications are for program, and we would like more time to work on that. Item number 2, that the challenge program continue to provide time for students to meet with intellectual peers. That issue, I don't know if you read Sunday's paper, but there was an article that spoke to that. But there's also the issue of what meeting with intellectual peers and under what circumstances that should or should not occur, in terms of globally gifted students or students that have a high interest or high ability in specific areas. How do we determine that? So there's some gray area there. Number 5, is starred simply because we have just begun to look seriously at what a K-5 program would look like in light of the changes that we're looking at in the elementary program. And one of the recommendations, the one just before that, number four, alludes to that, and what we will do is we would like to expand that team to include the administrators and the teachers from the Pond Cove School. I think it's really important that they're involved in that since it will be their program. And number 12, again, this was a concern about how we go about change and to be sure that any changes that we look at or propose go through a process of curriculum change and that that change be very carefully monitored. And that would be that no existing programs be eliminated until the curriculum development process results in the successful piloting of a program which is shown to be more beneficial than what it is to replace. And we're, as a committee, we're not exactly sure how we would measure more beneficial, how much time that change would take. So for those three areas, what we would propose is that we would work on this through the month of May and come back to you with a proposal for specifically grade four for next year.
Thank you. Any questions of Chris?
I have a question. Chris, over the last year, you have sent me and presumably other members of the board a lot of information on middle schools. In the last 48 hours, I reread some of this, and I was struck by the recurrence of phrases like this. The clear consensus that emerges from research studies done years ago and reinforced by those most recently completed is that ability grouping generally simply does not yield its presumed achievement advantage. The practice of grouping students by ability for instructional purposes is not supported by research. I won't read them all, but there are five or six here. And finally, I went down along with John Holt and some of the teachers to the Kennebunk School, which is apparently quite is a model middle school. And the description of their gifted and talented program reads like this. Project GRASP, an acronym which stands for Giftedness Reaching and Serving People, began as a pilot project sanctioned by the State Department of Education. Its purpose was to identify a talent in every child, grades 4 through 8. Now operating in grades K through 8, this program provides enrichment workshops in a variety of academic and non-academic areas to students on a bi-monthly schedule during the school day. I probably read one sentence more than I had to of that. But in reading this, these articles, and I believe that you collaborated on this state report, didn't you? Mm-hmm. Which says in one place heterogeneous grouping is recommended. In another place, local school systems provide co-curricular activities, both athletic and non-athletic, which meets the developmental needs of middle-level students and which encourage participation of many students rather than just a few select students. We have not had our debate on what a true middle school is and whether we're going to implement one, but I was just struck by the difficulty of reconciling our existing gifted and talented program, the challenge program, with how research describes what the ideal middle school should be and what seems to be the national trend, and I'd just like you to comment on that.
Well, essentially, I think the dissonance occurs when you take a look at what a middle school tries to do is it tries to develop individualized programs for students based on what their needs are. and that if you have, if you do identify a group of students that, let's say, have a great interest, say, in science, and they are willing and able to do more difficult projects. They're willing to put the extra time into it, and in fact, there is a resource person who is willing to help these kids with that, with extra time. What you get is you would get a group which is self-identified or identified through the curriculum. And so, in a sense there, because you're trying to address the needs of individual students, as you would in a middle school, this group gets identified and you actually will get some lessening, you'll get some homogeneous grouping. The issue is, how do we identify that? And the reason that you look at the way you identify students is what kind of an effect will it have, not only on them, but on their peers as well. So it's kind of a balancing game. I would say that we need to look very carefully at how we identify those kids and the reasons that we identify them. We are in the beginning stages of a discussion of how we might do that. It's kind of a, I use the term, a multi-tiered system, you know, where there are students that may be universally gifted and are outstripping the curriculum, they're outstripping the teacher's ability to provide for them within the classroom. And it may be appropriate for those students to have some time with a teacher, a resource person, or with one another to work 2, 3, 4 grade levels above their classmates. Now, you may also have some that are highly able in only specific subject areas, and perhaps they would work within the classroom, or perhaps, again, you might have a specific project that these kids are somehow selected for, which is part of the Kenny Bunk model as well. And beyond that, you would have even another tier of students that are very interested, have some abilities, and that they would, with the help of the classroom teacher and a consultant, do some types of enrichment, some extension activities within the classroom. And really, I guess what we're looking for is flexibility there. It fits in with the state guidelines that have been put out, which I have under Appendix A in the report. But they also fit in, that kind of a model fits in with Appendix B, which is the philosophy statement of the school system, which does allow for students to work with their ability peers when appropriate. And the issue then is, when is it appropriate for students to work with their ability peers?
Before we get to other questions, Peter, do you have a follow-up to your question?
I have a follow-up, but it also could be dealt with as a totally different question.
Either way, what I was going to do is try to stay on. If there's a follow-up question to that, then you can go and ask your next. I have a follow-up question to yours. Do you have a follow-up question? All right, I just have...
When you talk about this multi-layer, we're really only talking about two groups, two homogenized groups. One that the state says, I think, the state says they'll fund for 5% of the students, which is the gifted and talented. And the other is under the statutory heading in the state statute of special education. Mm-hmm. Now, those are the only two groups I know of where we group by ability peer. And one is 5%. I don't know what it comes out. And the state statute doesn't specify, obviously, a limit on the other, but I think we're, what?
4%.
12%. So you'll have state statute saying 5% for one grouping of ability peers, In our school system, the other remaining group is 12%.
Well, the 5%, it's not, the state doesn't say that you must group by ability for those students. What it says is you have to provide appropriate programming for
yeah,
them.
Yeah, your distinction is well taken. That's right. But that's not my point.
Okay.
Those are the only two groups. And you were talking about taking students, and we look at the individual needs of all students. But what I see happening is that you only end up with two groups. That in our particular school system, if you take, let's assume 5% and 12%, that's 17%. The 83% represent an absence of peer ability grouping. That is the non-group, 83%. So I just want, I mean, when you talk about in that 83%, you're not differentiating at all.
I'm proposing that we differentiate services for more of those students. In other words, I'm saying let's expand, let's look at expanding services for those students. In other words, right now our 5% is our students that are identified through our testing is, I guess I'll use the term universally gifted. You know, we give them tests which kind of are IQ tests, which are general. And I guess what I'm saying is let's take a look at what about students that may not test out as generally gifted, but also may also have ability and interest. It's not just a pure ability. We know that many students will make up more than enough in terms of their exuberance for learning, and we also know that expectations play a very large role in how well students do. And to, number one, make sure that our expectations of the general curriculum are high enough, and then number two, the students that can reach even beyond that are identified and are actually given that higher standard to shoot for, and to really open that up. Without taking away the services to those students that are identified as universally gifted.
One more question. Yeah. I didn't really understand. Peter asked about Kennebunk and the distinction. And I'd like, if you can do this in just a paragraph or two, that the distinction, if any exists, between the program in Cape Elizabeth and the program in Kennebunk. What is it in layman's terms that distinguishes the two programs to the extent they can be distinguished?
I would say that Kennebunk's program is more subject content specific, and there is a beginning and an end of a project, whereas Cape Elizabeth's program is an ongoing, not only a year-long program, but it goes right through the middle school.
I still don't understand.
Go ahead. This is my follow-up question. I think this may make it clear. One of the comments that I heard the most as I got input from parents and from educators was that our present program is characterized by many people as being one in which a make-it-or-break-it test is given at the end of the third grade, and that's it for the gifted and talented program for the next 5 years. I do not have any statistics on that, but I would like to see how much turnover there was, how many students actually were able to enter the gifted and talented program at a later date, or who left it for whatever reason. And I asked this question in the context of a memorandum of Lyle Kramer's that I came across in my reading, in which he said that in classes in the school, the chronological age gap can run from 24 to 33 months in our school. I put that together with the recent education that Jan and others have given me on Piaget's research about I think Michael also is a guilty party, about spurts in development. And if you combine those developmental and chronological ages, you would probably get a gap much bigger than 33 months. You might get 3 years. You might get more. So the question is it reasonable to take a snapshot of the third graders and say, that's basically it? And would it be possible to have a system that is more fluid and more dynamic? Maybe the testing at third grade wouldn't be quite as rigorous. It's quite rigorous now. It's quite a long process. And have some process that would focus on this issue every single year, perhaps more often. Is that feasible? Is it a reasonable line of questioning?
To two of the questions, the answer is yes.
Which two?
Well,
can I take my pick?
Yes. No. I guess, you know, the first one is it is reasonable to assume that there could be that gap, that much of a gap. But regardless of the gap, there are development, intellectual development, and ability at that age, especially at the middle level age, especially fourth and fifth, and I'm sure before that. I don't know a lot about previous to that. But 1 year, a kid will have a great year, and the next year, a kid will just kind of be normal, and that's fine. But I would say that I would be in favor of a system which was more fluid, which did give a kid multiple chances to be identified. I would also say that I can't put a measure on the fluidity. What I can tell you is that on the average, in recent history, we've had 3 or 4 students each year come into the program after the fourth grade. We've also had 3 or 4 students drop out, both in terms of their own feeling about it and also in terms of their being counseled out by the teachers and sometimes by parents as well. So whether that's a lot of fluidity, you know, it's kind of a subjective thing.
You're talking about the entire 5 grades, so yeah. That would be less than 10% turnover.
Yeah.
Per year, there are 50 or 60
I would say so.
Students in the program in the 5 grades.
For the longer history, you know, if there's one of the challenge people here, they might be able to speak to that.
I think one of the important points that is the difference between Kennebunk and us is the line that Peter read about all children's specialness being recognized. And I think that's a very different statement than what we do here, where we give a test and we pick 10 and we say, you are globally gifted. We label them as that. And we say, and the rest of you are not. I think that that's a very different philosophical approach and a very important point.
You agree that that's a different philosophical approach?
It is different. It is different. And I would say that the process that we're going through now is examining that. For some people, it will be too much, and for others, it won't be soon enough.
Okay. Hey, incidentally, if you'll permit me to ask one statistical question, I have a background here. 5% is the state statute. We have more than 5%, do we not?
I think we try to hold it to 5%, but it's a guideline. It's not.
There's 17 in seventh grade, I believe.
Yeah.
No. Is Marty here?
It's only 14.
14. Does that include math?
Well, what is what percentage? What in seventh grade you got 105 kids.
There's 14 kids.
You got 14 kids, so somebody down here, tell me what it is.
Who's got a calculator?
For 12%.
Thank you, Peter. I was looking at you for the answer. So that's 13%. So that's what we do run much more than 5%.
Well, there's some historical. There have been changes apparently in the past 3 years in terms of they've tightened up how many are allowed in. That has also cut down on the number that have dropped out.
Excuse me one second. Peter, unless you're going to change the percentage, I'm going to call on you in a minute because we're going to open it up to public discussion.
Okay, yes, I would like to change the percentage. Speaking from experience, I can say that in the fourth grade, when I entered the program, it was around at least 18% in the fourth grade, and that went down to a 7% in the eighth grade.
Okay, thank you very much. All right, so now, the difference between the 5% and the 14% or the 18% is that the state funds 5% and the town, any difference, any percentage over 5%, the town funds, as I understand. Is that right, Dee? Does that seem right?
It's all worked in the form.
All right. Okay.
The reimbursement factor is different. That's all.
Okay, now, any more questions of Chris on his presentation report? I tell you what I would propose to do, school board, if it's all right with you, after we're through cross-examining and working over Chris, I would, because we have a lot of people here from the public who want to speak on this issue, since public comment is on the agenda normally at the end of the superintendent's report after we will have dealt with this. I'm going to change the order. Yeah, it would be the next item. So I think we ought to have public comment now, unless people have more questions of Chris. We're going to ask Chris to come back after the public
comment. That's right, yeah, I'd like that.
Okay. Reserve so, Chris, why don't you stand? We'll probably want to ask you some more questions after we have public comment. And would each person please identify themselves when they step out and try to limit their comments, if they can, to 3 or 4 minutes if there are a lot of people here.
My name is Kay Z. I've had 2 children in the challenge program. They both enjoyed it, and I thought it was well taught. And at one point, I think about 4 years ago, I don't know if Harold remembers, but I called Harold and said, Harold, don't get rid of the challenge program. It's wonderful. Don't take it from our children. I'd still like to say what's taught in challenge I think is wonderful, and I hope that it won't be taken away from our children, but I do hope that it would be expanded. From observing what my fifth grader gets in the regular classroom, it's really not enough for most children. I think that more children could do the work that's offered in challenge. I think we need the teachers who could bring the children up to that level and would have high expectations for them, as Chris mentioned. At this point, I really wouldn't want challenge to disappear because I don't think the classroom is ready for the other children. At the same time, I feel badly for the other children because I really believe they could do a lot more. And from all the parents I've talked to, they've always been asking for more for their children. And I think Chris knows that, and he's trying to respond to that. I think most of you know that education is one of my pet projects, and I just read Escalante's book.
What is it?
Escalante's book, which I really, Harold, you would love it. So it's for him.
Okay? I'll read it.
It's at Bookland. Escalante's a Spanish teacher who was from Bolivia, and he just believed that children could do well if they had, I'm not going to say the Spanish word right, ganas. And that was a desire to learn, a burning desire to learn. He had a burning desire to teach, and he brought children in eastern Los Angeles to high levels of achievement in his calculus class. I'd just like to share with you, because I know there are some people who firmly believe challenge is the only way to go and that children should be tracked. Let me read from the book. This is what Escalante believes. He also dismissed the gifted student program even when it became the responsibility of men he respected. For Latino children just growing accustomed to English, an intelligence test at age 7 had many drawbacks. The system made it difficult to test new students later on and forbade retesting children already on the gifted list. If we retest them and find that they are not achieving at that level anymore, we don't get any money for them. Besides, it costs $70 just to test somebody. That's what one of the administrators told him. Intelligence tests were written and administered by psychologists, and Escalante hated that. He hated the idea of putting students on tracks. This went to college, that went to McDonald's. He wanted to leave his door open to anyone with ganas. He proudly displayed his calculus roster, where gifted students were always a minority. This did not surprise Senator Martin. These were two other people in his school. They estimated that by the high school level, half of the students rated gifted in elementary school were no longer performing at that level. By the time AP calculus classes grew large enough to provide a roughly accurate sample, gifted students proved themselves the least successful of any identifiable group. They made up only about 20% of the calculus team, and only about half of them passed the AP examination with a 3 or better. Now, when you read the book, you'll realize that the pupils in his class did well because he really made them work. He offered extra hours after school. He was always there for the kids. That was his love. And maybe we don't have teachers like that at the Cape. I mean, this man really worked. Maybe we do. I haven't been in calculus yet with my children at the Cape. But I think the point is, and this is an Oriental feeling too, and it is different from an American feeling. A lot of Americans feel that children do well if their IQ is high and they have a special knack for doing it. Oriental families feel that if you work hard, you do well. Myself, I prefer that, and I think I agree with the book, that more things should be open to more children. Standards should not be lowered. They should just be expected to work very, very hard. And that's what Mrs. Russ does in Challenge. And the parents support the child. I think if you only look at IQ and you keep screening children out because of some test, you deny children a lot. And one other thing. This school has never tried to educate the next 10 in this way. Why don't you give it a try? Take those next 10 kids, give them a small class, try an experiment. The other thing I'd suggest is maybe you have some teachers who would like to teach writing in the way the Challenge teaches writing. And maybe some parents would like their child to work harder. Have a sign-up list. Have an experiment. Let's try. But, you know, I get disgusted with all these committees. You know, it takes about 4 years before we get anything done, and then the kid's out of the school.
Can I make an editorial comment? Say, after 6 years, I really, that's a very nice present for me. Anyway, thank you. As a speech I've made myself once or twice over the last 6 years. Next, Peter.
I'm Peter Freilinger, and I guess I could say that I'm a former Challenge student. First of all, I'd like to say a few things about the what I heard from Mr. Toy and Mrs. Z. Now, Mr. Toy mentioned a number of statistics about the percentage of kids in the Challenge class and how these percentages are determined, both by state funding and by testing at the local school level. Now, I know I can present examples where students did not have to be tested to enter a program. My friend Peter Hand out in the audience is one of these. He came in a year later than most students would. Also, many students find that that Challenge is for them and come into the program beyond even the fifth grade. Others leave later because they find Challenge is not for them. Mrs. Z mentioned that maybe we could try making the next 10% of kids give them a class and let them try. As much as I know Mrs. Z would support this, I don't think this is feasible in any way. We'd end up having 10% classes, which would in effect be leveling. And I know a lot of people in Cape Elizabeth are not in support of leveling. First of all, and lastly, I'd like to say something on my own. I was involved in the Challenge program from the third grade to the eighth grade, and I skipped the fifth grade, so that's 5 years. And for those 5 years, I was involved with Mr. Watts for every year in a math program. Ms. Thompson for 1 year in the fourth grade program, and Ms. Russ for 1 year in the sixth grade program. The math program for Mr. Watts probably taught me more than any other class I've had in my entire life, and I've been in school for 9 years, so I think I have some experience in that. He taught me more than just math. He taught me about life in general. And it sounds like a commercial plug, but he was easily the best teacher I have ever experienced in my entire life. Ms. Thompson was similar to this. She taught me more than just Challenge. And she taught us to a great extent that because we were in the Challenge class did not make us better than other students. It made us Challenge students and nothing more. Mrs. Russ also taught me a great deal, more of an academic nature than a philosophy nature, but she still taught me a great deal. And But I don't feel that because I gained a lot from this program, that everyone could gain a lot from this program. I feel that there are some students who are globally gifted, I believe the term is, and could gain from any program that they are given. But there are many students who will not gain regardless of the program that they receive. There are some students that would be benefited by a program dealing with one specific section of their needs, but to do that is not economically or time-wise feasible. So I think in the end, we have to consider that not everyone is going to be benefited by even a specialized program, but we can't ignore those children who are benefited by a global program. And for my personal opinion, I think a challenge program is necessary for teaching these students who are globally gifted. Perhaps a generalized program for these non-globally gifted, so to speak, children would be a help, but a specialized program would, to me, not be feasible, and it would just be ridiculous. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Next.
My name is Jeff White. I haven't been in this challenge program. I'm not an educator, so I'm speaking from perhaps a different perspective than some. I have children in the Cape Elizabeth schools. I believe that the idea of a challenge program is a sensible one, and if Peter is an example of its product, he certainly represents kinds of things that we would expect that kind of a program to achieve. I also think, however, that gifts and talents and intelligence are not absolutes. There is a continuum from one point to another, as there is in this room, as there is in all walks of life, as there is in our schools. I think there are children who are good students in our schools in Cape Elizabeth, as there are everywhere, who conscientiously approach their work, who have support of their parents, who would have even more support of their parents in achieving if their parents had the tools and the knowledge of what the right things to do and the right curriculum that they could pursue at home would be. And when I heard Chris describe the attributes of a program to challenge people, I heard him say three things. First, that the program ought to be individualized to serve the needs of the particular student. Secondly, the students and presumably their parents who support them ought to be willing to devote the time and energy to the program to achieve and to meet the challenges that are presented to them. And thirdly, there ought to be a resource person reasonably available to serve them. Presumably, all of those are attributes of the challenge programs that we have. From my own perspective, they are also attributes that would serve most or a substantial number of the children in our school and would challenge them. In a very rudimentary way, I kind of look at this situation as a situation in which you can put any number of people on a horse. Some of them may get to their destination faster. Some of them may get to destinations farther away. But if you have five horses and you give two students one horse each, and you leave the rest with the remaining horses, the two students that have the two horses for themselves all the time are probably going to end up being better riders. So I guess I've cast my lot with the expansionist group, although I do appreciate and I do support the existence of the challenge program and the opportunities that it presents to those who are in it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jeff. Next, please. Any other comments?
My name is Kate Putnam. I have a son who's in the third grade now who is a potential candidate, I believe, for a challenge program next year. And I think I'm concerned that it's May. We don't really have any guidelines for the fourth grade program yet, which I understand takes time. But I guess I'm also concerned about our labeling of our children, too. I think children are labeled enough a lot, and I don't know how I feel about having my son go into middle school being labeled gifted and talented. And I don't know how that affects him with his peers as well. I think the pressure that I've talked to other parents whose children have had these tests during the summer, and it seems to me that it's a lot of pressure on our children to prove something to somebody that they're in the top 5% of their class or whatever, that I don't know how it affects their peer relationships later on in the fourth grade. You have 5% of these children who are in a challenge program, and how does that affect their peer relationships with the other 95% of their peers? Because I think at this age, that's an important consideration to our children as well. I know I have a son who needs to be challenged. I know I have a son who is academically needs that extra work or whatever, but I also have a son who is very comfortable in his peer group, and I want to see that remain. I really have problems labeling children and separating them from their mainstream or whatever. I think that my son has benefited to this point anyway by being in a classroom with all sorts of ability levels. I think that he benefits from being able to share his gifts or his talents with those that he can sort of work with and vice versa. He learns from them and they learn from him, and I think that's nice. At this point, you know, I'm a little confused about the program and where it's headed to, as I guess a lot of us are. But, you know, I don't know. That's what I wanted to say anyway. But I do have a problem with labeling, and I do have a problem with taking that only that 5% and making them special. Where what are the others? I mean, I think every child is special, and I think that those every child's specialness should be recognized. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I've never observed your son in the classroom, but I know him to be a gifted athlete.
Next. Any other comments from the public? Yes.
Hi, my name is Peter Hand, and I had a few questions for Mr. Toy to start with.
Now you're going to examine poor Chris Toy? After we work him over, you want to examine him?
My first question was, you talked about consistently strong academic standards in the normal classroom. Compared to that standard, where do you think the classes are now?
Well, now, look, how are we going to work this out? Have you had a lot of questions for Mr. Toy?
I have two.
Oh, two questions. All right, Chris, why don't you stand up next to Peter, and
all right.
Are you going to go to law school?
It's hard to say exactly, you know, where it is. What I can tell you is the perception is out there that it's uneven. In other words, on more than one occasion, one of the questions that was asked on the survey that went to parents is, do you feel that the regular classroom curriculum is appropriately challenging for your child? And several parents said, well, it depends on who they have for a teacher, which would indicate to me that it is uneven. The extent of that unevenness, hard to quantify. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
All right. Next.
I also wanted to ask about the turnover rate. As Peter mentioned before, we started with about 20% of our class approximately, and we ended up with 8 or 9% of the class. I'd say that's a fairly high turnover rate.
Right.
So I think there's more fluidity than most people think there is.
Well, it's changed over time. I think when you folks went in, they accepted a larger number of students, which would mean that it's possible with a greater percentage of students that you would have more students that couldn't make the grade once they were in. In other words, the testing procedure didn't accurately reflect who should or should not be in given the curriculum. In recent years, what they've done is they've made the test more stringent. And so it's more difficult to get in, so fewer students get in. Therefore, it tends to be those students, if it's a good selection process, whatever you're trying to do, fewer of them will drop out.
Okay.
So that's why you have a lower turnover rate today than you had when you got in.
Okay, thank you.
How's that?
Yep.
Right, thank you.
I am a former challenge student, and the program started in fourth grade when I went through the system, and I came in fifth grade, a year after it started. I don't remember any tests, taking any tests, and frankly, I don't know how I got into the program. I don't know whether to consider myself globally talented when I entered the program, but when I left, I felt much more rounded than I did previously. When I came into the program, I knew I had some kind of talent in math and science, and I was able to understand those very easily. But when it came to writing and English, I didn't have much of an idea of what I was doing. And through the challenge program that I went through, I was able to develop that talent. I don't know if I made it in because I had an average writing talent and an exceptional math talent, but I think people who do have those, I think they are able to hang on to the program and learn and develop their writing talents. I can also attest that this is the only class that I never came home from and quoted it as being boring. It was always challenging to me compared to my other subjects. I was very rarely challenged in math or other subjects like that. But in challenge, I always had something that I was working on. I was always improving myself, and it went far beyond the class curriculum that I was exposed to otherwise. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You'll have to come up here because you're on the tube.
State funding for the challenge program.
Would you identify yourself,
yes,
madam?
I'm Barbara Newcomb. State funding for the challenge program is 5%. 5% in Van Buren, Maine, 5% in Cape Elizabeth, Maine. Do you not think that more than 5% of the children in Cape Elizabeth, Maine would qualify for challenge than would in Van Buren, Maine, for instance?
I'm going to stay away from that, won't I?
would you like to choose a different town in Maine?
It's all yours. I don't want
D says,
one is the most affluent town in Maine, and one is the poorest town in Maine.
Well, we need to, what I think your question could be phrased this way. If you take a school system where not all, by a long shot, but a large majority of the parents of the school children in the affluent suburb are educated, ambitious for their children, involved in the school system, and then compare it with a rural, very much less advantaged community in the same state where a very small percentage of the parents of the school children have advanced degrees, are college educated, and a very small percentage are involved in the schools or academically ambitious for their children, would you have a difference in the number of kids that might profit from it? And you're asking me the question, and I would say yes, and the reason I would say yes, there would be a difference, is that I asked the question, and I've said this five times over the last 5 years, and I'm going to say it my last meeting one more time. I asked this former superintendent of schools and now the chancellor of education in Scarsdale, New York. What about the gifted and talented program, and how do you view it? How did you view it in Scarsdale? I also want to point out, incidentally, that this young man is a graduate of the Scarsdale school system. And he said, I either have 2 or 2,000. I don't know which, depending on your definition. Okay. So that's the answer I would give you.
Uh-huh. In fourth grade, there are over 125 students, and there are 10 children in challenge. I really wish that they could expand that class a little bit. Thank you.
Wait. We can't have a debate. Anybody else who has not spoken yet who wishes to speak? Well, you haven't spoken yet, Sue, and I think you wish to speak. Would you please come forward?
My name is Susan Rouser, and I have a son in fourth grade in the Challenge program. My son is very happy in the program, and my husband and I are very, very happy with the program. Before the meeting gets held up anymore, I'd like to request or ask the board if they would consider having a workshop on this topic. I've talked to a few of the board members, and they seem interested in that. The Challenge program has been in place 12 years. These teachers have invested a lot of time in the program. There have been modifications and changes. But I think we're going to go back and forth with different viewpoints tonight. I think it's very important. I think the community needs to have more time to give some input on it. And I was wondering if we could ask for a certain time.
Well, what? I've been getting input for 6 years on this, and I think what we'll do, Sue, is we'll proceed with the agenda, with the comments, try to inform ourselves as best we can. I suspect that the Challenge program will be discussed in this school system regularly, several times a year, for the next decade. So I think my guess is that probably every year for the next 5 or 6 years, there'll be workshops, probably more than one, on Challenge. So I think your point is well taken. I think there'll be continual discussion of it.
I would just, I guess my point is, before there's any major revision made in a program, Mrs. Putnam mentioned, it is May. The school year is definitely winding down, and if there's thought, it seems that I haven't seen the recommendations that Mr. Toy and his committee have prepared. I've just heard them tonight. I haven't had a chance to digest them and think about them, and there may be other people in the community that really want to review those and then come up with some insights.
Well, I do think there'd be opportunity for that. I think if the school board has views on this issue, I think they should be heard, and I think that the board has read the report. The purpose of making the report to the board is to get feedback from the board, and the board ultimately makes the policy here. And I think what I would like to see as chairman, receive the report, hear from people about their views that may be relevant to the report, and then we'll respond to the superintendent about the report and tell them what our views are.
Okay. So you're just accepting the report tonight, and you're going to wait now for?
No, I think we my view is that there's a report, and we'll probably listen to members of the public. We suggested to Chris that he may want to stand by, because we may, after we hear from the public, may want to ask him some questions. And then I'm going to ask the board their views on the report. And then we'll give the superintendent the necessary board feedback on the report.
Okay. Thank you.
My name is Margaret Wilkes, and I didn't really come prepared to speak tonight. I was going someplace else tonight until Peter Leslie told me what was on the agenda. So here I am. But as I sat here tonight and listened to everything that everybody had to say, I found it to all be very interesting. I have a daughter who is in the Challenge program. I wanted to respond to Mr. Toy's response to Peter Hand's question of him about the curriculum in the people who are on the last three horses. And he said, well, then you have to ask what teacher the child has and you'll get the answer. And I think that's a big problem here. There's no curriculum that has been determined that everyone should get. It depends on the teacher. And I think that, the children are learning different things in different classes. I think also that children are put into situations at the beginning of the school year, they're given tests, they're put into groups, and especially in math, it doesn't allow for any change and any growth throughout the year. And so that they have to stay, that the children who are doing better within a group still have to stay with everyone else. And within the group, the individualism of the children should be identified. I have a son who is in second grade, and I find that in the lower school, they're starting to do that. They're starting to recognize spurts in growth, and they're starting to meet those requirements in those children. And I wish that we could see it in the higher grades also. I think the challenge program needs to be looked at. I think it's an okay program. I know my daughter is benefiting from it. I think it's given her greater self-esteem, but I think that a lot of other children could benefit from it as well. I don't know what the answer is, but I think that we need a curriculum that is has more continuity. Thank you.
Next, please.
Hi, my name is Susan Dana, and I have a daughter that's in kindergarten at Pond Cove School right now. I'm also certified to teach in Maine grades K through 12, so I'm speaking both as a parent and as an educator. I am home full-time with my children right now. But Katie has just been designated this spring as a child that would benefit from a gifted and talented program. She's reading beyond her grade level. And I've just came home on the agenda from school yesterday. That's one thing just aside from this. It'd be nice if we get a copy of the agenda before the day before the school board meetings. I came home in the backpack yesterday. I've had very little time to prepare for this. I just saw gifted and talented, and I didn't really know what it entailed. So that's just a suggestion that might be helpful if we had the agenda for the school board meetings, maybe a week in advance, maybe if it could be published in the Cape Courier or whatever. But I have to agree with what Mr. Toy has said, in that all children deserve to be challenged and receive the best instruction for them. And I know very little about the challenge program since Katie is our oldest daughter and she is in kindergarten right now, but I would hope that there's going to be something in place that is going to challenge her by the time she's in fourth grade. I think one problem that we're confronting here is people seem to perceive a gifted and talented program as an elitist type program. We live in a democracy. We like to think that all children have an opportunity to get the best education, which is true. They do. As an educator, I firmly believe in that. But I also have come to realize, I've read every book possible in Gorham at the university about gifted and talented students, and I've come to realize that they have very different emotional needs and psychological needs, and these needs have to be met. And they, for example, just a few statistics, this might help Mrs. Newcomb that asked a question, that gifted and talented is through all socioeconomic groups. It's not necessarily just in a community such as in Cape Elizabeth. It would benefit 5% of the children in Van Buren, as well as in Cape Elizabeth. And this is in, it's the Gifted and Talented, a Guide for Parents, published by the Maine State, the Maine Department of Educational Cultural Services, which is an excellent resource book. Those of you on the board, I'd recommend if you haven't read this, it really defines what a gifted and talented child is and how they are different socially, psychologically, intellectually. But as far as that question, this is one of the common misconceptions. Gifted children are white middle-class youngsters. That's false. Gifted children are found in all ethnic, cultural, and or religious groups, and they're included in all socioeconomic classifications. So to answer that question, it is given in this. So it's not strictly an elitist program simply for upper middle class children that live in very affluent communities with parents that are very well educated. Just a few other things. I was at a conference last week in Augusta for foreign language teachers, and I went to a special session on teaching gifted and talented children in the foreign language classroom. Just a few statistics. They think that about 30% of high school dropouts are gifted children that have become underachievers. They're not challenged in their classrooms, and there's a desperate need to conform, which we know all children have this need to conform and be normal. They get teased if they answer the questions, and that is a very, very big problem. A lot of our underachievers in our schools are gifted children, and that's where I agree with a lot of the comments about the testing. I think just a one-shot test is not the answer. These children, I'm sure there are many children that have not been identified, and I think we are going to have to come up with maybe some better ways to test our children and identify the gifted children, which I think was recommended in the committee, and I would agree with that. But that would be one way to eliminate some of maybe the underachievement. And also they say that gifted and talented students, the ones maybe that are globally gifted and talented, spend 40 to 60% of their time in their classroom waiting for others to catch up and to finish the assignment. They need the instructions only once, and that's it, they've got it. They don't have to hear it repeated 3 and 4 times. They can finish the assignment in 5 or 10 minutes. So I think that a program such as the Challenge Program is going to give these children an opportunity to be with peers, to be with someone on an intellectual level, and it's going to make them feel less isolated in the classroom, and they're not going to be as apt to conform or to adjust by not answering questions, by being quiet. And a lot of times I've had this problem in class. I've had students who I know are very bright, and they just are not challenged. You can only do so much as a teacher with 30 students in your classroom. You can provide some enrichment, but it would be wonderful to have a resource person to help out. But they can also become troublemakers in the classroom, the underachievers. But I just would like to say I hope that the challenge program is not just going to be eliminated without something else put in its place that has been, as Mr. Toy mentioned, a pilot program that has proved itself, that is going to challenge these children, that they're not going to be stuck in a classroom where the teacher, and this is another very big concern as an educator, is how do the classroom teachers feel about this? The teachers, we've been very, very pleased with the teachers we've had at Pond Cove School this year. And they, it's from what I can see, they do so much work as it is right now. And if you're going to expect them to deal with each of these children on an individual basis, even though they have a resource person, they're the one that ultimately are going to have to implement these programs and follow through with these gifted and talented children. So I really think we're going to have to look at how much we're demanding of our classroom teachers and how much in-service time, because I think it would take a lot of training for the teachers and how to deal with the gifted and talented. So that's another big concern, is how much more we can expect the classroom teachers to do. And I'd be afraid that without a challenge program or something where these children can get out of the classroom, have something to look forward to, such as, I think it was Peter Hand, I'm not sure, look forward to, is the one class he had that he was not bored with. I just think it's what I was going to say, whatever. It's just very important to keep the challenge program in place as it is. And I would even like to see it continue, and I would agree with this multi-tiered approach where the challenge program is still in place, but then other children who, for example, may excel verbally or may excel artistically or may excel musically can then be enriched or have enrichment programs in those areas. And then the third tier where they might have an extension in some area. I mean, I do agree that all children should benefit from this, but we have to keep in mind that gifted and talented children learn differently and they have very special needs, and I think we have to keep that in mind and cater to their needs as well as to the needs of the other students. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments?
Hi, my name is Helene Hornby. I've had a daughter who's gone through the entire challenge program, and I have a son who's currently in the challenge program. Between them, they've had Mary Jo Thompson, Carolyn Russ, and Marty Watts, who are all absolutely excellent teachers. Mary Jo Thompson taught my daughter, I think in fourth grade, how to write, and she really carried that through. She's in ninth grade now. She's carried that through her entire academic career, and I'm very grateful to Mary Jo for this. The idea that the learning can be reinforced in the classroom, I think, is admirable, but I don't think it tells the whole picture, because as my daughter was writing certain kind of essays and themes in the challenge class, at the very same time she had her regular English class where the level of her papers were so far below what she was doing in the other class, and they were simultaneously, because the expectations were not there. She was writing book reports in one class that just recounted what the story was, and in the other class she was analyzing the literature and forming opinions about it. And so, you know, it might be nice to say reinforce it in the classroom, but the teacher really has to set those standards in the classroom too. And in many cases it does happen, but in many cases it doesn't. I think that we should enrich the classroom programs. And there was another circumstance where poetry was taught in the, I think it was in the regular classroom program, but a teacher came in and was teaching the young children how to do metaphors and similes in the regular classroom, and a lot of really good poetry was produced by all the children in the classroom. So, you know, I have seen it work where the classroom can be enriched, and I think it should be, and I think that we should have more fluidity in people getting in and out of challenge and it not just be one test. And I think that it's fine to review the selection criteria, but I definitely do not think we should take away what's here now, because it's a very good program. And in terms of peer relationships, I've noticed with both my children that challenge is only a very small part of the day. The vast majority of the day, they're with all the children, and it does not, in my opinion, it has not affected peer relationships in any negative way. They're totally integrated with all the children for the, you know, the majority of the day. And I just want to also commend Mr. Watts especially as well, because he takes a very great personal interest in the children, and their success is like his success, and I think the children really put out for him, and if they can operate two and three grades, learn two and three grades above what they're doing in the regular classroom, they should be given the opportunity to do that.
Thank you. Any other comments? So,
I'm Susan Mitchell. I have a child in third grade, sixth grade, and eighth grade. One of my children is in challenge. I guess I feel, probably I'm summarizing a lot of people's statements tonight, but I feel like we don't need to take something away to gain what we really are trying to get. And I think the goal is to recognize that all children have special talents and needs. But we do have a great challenge program in the process right now that is serving the needs of a certain group of individuals. And I don't think we need to say that these children are globally gifted and you are not, but in fact, shouldn't we be saying these children are globally gifted, we have a program for you, and others are talented, and we do not have enough in process for these other children. Instead of taking away from what other kids have in supporting their needs, we should be supporting the needs of the other children by raising the expectations in the classroom, providing the visiting artists that we've provided those this year. I think it's a wonderful program that's ongoing. Increase it, expand it, broaden the base, put some more math, science, whatever those needs are that we see in the individual classrooms as teachers. The teachers can look at this. They can meet in workshops and say, we have an abundance of children who would really benefit from a special science program, special math program, a special art program. Let's recognize that, but I don't think we need to tear down one to build up another. We're just really saying, I think, let's raise the expectations. Let's get the classroom, push it up, keep it coming, make it interesting. And I don't think we need to take away from the program that is really sufficient and challenging to children who do fit into that category.
Thank you. Any others? If not, I would propose that we have a board discussion now. We've completed the public discussion, and I would ask once more if there's any more public discussion, because from now on, you know, after we close off that part, it's going to be a board discussion, a deliberative session here, just to have the board discuss it and come forth with it, whatever views they may have on the subject of the report and the recommendations. So I don't want anybody to say I'm unfair, which I'm accused of all the time, at home, at work, here, and everywhere else. We're going to... Going? Going? Aha! I practically begged you to come forward.
I never spoke in public before. My name is Linda Metzger. I think Sue Mitchell spoke beautifully, and please, I really like the challenge program, and why is it such a threat, Harold, when you refer to the parent as you knew the child as being a gifted athlete? It's always bothered me that someone could be a gifted athlete, but you cannot be gifted intellectually. And I think it shouldn't be such a threat to everybody that you can be talented and gifted in that way when it's perfectly okay to be a star athlete. Why can't you be a star academically and therefore and automatically then you're isolated from your peers. You're not isolated from your peers when you're a star athlete.
A point very well made, and let me add that you should go over to the middle school and find out how many kids on each of the teams put forth by the middle school are told they cannot be on the team.
My son, who did well academically, was a bench warmer, and everybody in life has their adjustments, and I think it's part of growing up.
But everybody is permitted to be on the team and to do their best on the team. Some do better than others.
But when you, I'm afraid I don't want a challenge program eliminated, just like when you have a slow learner, you have special programs for them, and it is not a threat. I think it is the parents who are more threatened than the students. I think just like there's a slow learning programs, there have to be academically talented programs. They're polar ends, and each need needs to be met. I think it is more parents than it is children. And there was a very interesting article in the Sunday paper on challenge and high achievers, and I hope you read it.
I didn't.
That's a shame.
not because I intended to ignore it. I didn't come across it.
Oh.
Any other? Peter, once more, but then we're not going to have a second round here because it's 25 minutes of 10. This is it.
I know. I'll ring the bell after I'm done. First of all, I'd like to agree wholeheartedly with Mrs. Metzger. I agree on all of her points. And my second point, which will go really quickly, is that I believe that I was not socially hampered in any way by being a part of the challenge program. In fact, I believe my social life probably improved as a result of it.
Do you want to go a little deeper, Peter? You want to?
I just like to say that I don't think that if a kid's in challenge, that he's automatically going to be regarded as a nerd or a loser or a dweeb. So I don't think there's any foundation for the idea that because you're in challenge, because you're smart, because you're gifted, you're going to be made fun of or isolated from your peers. Thank you.
Ding ding.
Thank
Barbara,
you.
You're right. The statute also makes that differentiation. Gifted and talented is mentioned time and time again, and then at one point, I can't remember where, it refers to the highly gifted and talented. So that's a point well taken. It's quite important, really, because we probably, going back to Scarsdale, which now that Harold's no longer on the board, we won't have to hear about.
I'm on the board right now, I'll tell you.
He asked me to remind you every once in a while.
The highly gifted is presumably somebody who comes along, one or two a year, maybe one or two every 5 years, I don't know. But that's clearly a different category of student.
Well, let me, I'm going to ask all the board members for their views on the report. And what I'd like to do is develop for the superintendent a sense of the board. To the extent that we can do that, Superintendent, to the extent that there emerges some kind of a sense of how this board reacts to these recommendations, then I would like to have it, I'll guide the discussion here and see where we come out, but I would then suggest that if we agree with all of the recommendations that you then you want it, I'll stop, you go ahead. I'll start again.
There we go. I was having so much fun up here, I wanted my chance.
We're going to ask you more questions probably,
that's fine.
But go ahead.
Just before you begin that discussion, just a point of clarification here, and that is that
if it's
report,
procedure, I'll deal with it.
Okay, the report is to the board, and yep. The recommendations are to the planning team within the school.
Well, let me just say, and I expected that you would step forward. and say something about that, Chris. Let me say to you and all those who are interested in that issue that the board has before it a report. I think some of us at least want to tell people what in the report we agree with, and maybe if there's something we don't agree with it, what we don't agree with it. We're on television. The public has a right to know what our views are. And more than that, it's been my experience over the past 6 years that very little policy actually gets made by the board. Most things evolve in the school system, and they evolve through committee work. And if you look at the agenda for each meeting, the things that we actually act on are accepting resignations and things of that sort. This is a very important matter of educational policy. Recommendations have been made, and we're looking at them. To the extent it makes any difference to anybody what the board's views are, we're going to give them.
It does make a difference. Thank you.
Now, what? Did I finish with the, that we'd have a discussion here and see whether we could, whether we had any ration. We may agree with all of these, we may not. If the board doesn't agree with them all, then I would hope you, as chief administrator, Dr. Pelletier, would go back to your administrators and the committee and say, look, they agree with this, they agree with this, keep on going, good work, good job, right on. The policymakers are in sync with you. And if there is any area where there may be a slight divergence, we would hope that the board's views would be taken into consideration. If they're not, I think the board has the power ultimately to, at some appropriate time, not tonight, but to make motions, get seconds, and have votes. And I don't think anybody wants that. I mean, I don't think that's the way we ought to be. None of this should be done. We ought to try to do it communicating through you with your administrators and the committee, kind of a dialogue on these issues so that we come together on them rather than have people submitting final reports and say, here's the way we want it, and the board saying yes, no, period. So with that, let me say that when the five-year plan, and I'm just going to be the catalyst here, this has been an issue, this is my last meeting, it's been an issue that has been very important to me for all the time that I've been on the school board. I've had some tough times over this issue. I've had some people that I like get very upset with me, personally upset with me. It has not been an easy issue. Like those who have a view different than mine, I think I'm right, you think you're right. So neither of us can be absolutely certain we're right, we have opinions. I think that we have a gifted and talented program, and we're going to have a gifted and talented program here for quite a while because state law requires that we have it. But what kind of gifted and talented program we have depends on many things. The parents of the children who are in it have much to contribute to this debate because their children are gifted and they understand their children's needs. The teachers who participate in the program and who teach these kids have much to offer because professionally they know far more about it than we do. But in addition to that, parents whose children are not in the program, they have something to contribute to the debate as well. And finally, it should be recognized that this is a debate that is now beginning earnestly in the United States. Peter read some excerpts from studies. I went through this, all of these, not these same excerpts, but a good many articles when we had our workshop in this room a few Saturdays ago on tracking. And there's an enormous debate going on in this country among professional educators, not simply among parents. So it is true that parents whose children have not been labeled gifted, don't have any labels, should not feel threatened. And parents whose children have been in this wonderful program that we've heard about it, and it is wonderful because you've all said it's wonderful, you should not be threatened either. This is a public school system with a group of people, administrators, teachers, and school board members devoted for doing the greatest good for the greatest number to all of the children. Now, even the most vociferous supporters of the present system use the word fluidity tonight. So, I have two views on this. One, I don't think anything should be changed at all for children who went into the program now. They went into the program in fourth grade. My view is, let's put their parents' mind at ease. They're in it. We'll work it the same way that it's being worked now for them. Now, with respect to how we do it in the future for children that may come into the program in the future, my own view is, I think, consistent with what Mary Jo and others said to us when we took up the five-year plan. And what they said was that it is true that many of the things that we do with these children, we can try to do in a classroom. More and more children should benefit from these things. One person who got up here tonight said that, two people said that their children really learned to write in the gifted and talented program. The implication is that they wouldn't really have learned to write had they not been in the gifted and talented program. What about all these kids that we're turning out of this school system, who are in the non-program, who are not special? We want them to really learn how to write very, very well. Some will do better than others. Some will do poorly. Some will do superbly. But they all, in my judgment, should get the same opportunity. The ones who do better will probably be more intellectually gifted. Incidentally, it's a word that I personally don't like to use, but I use it because that's the jargon that we use. And those who are not intellectually powerful probably won't do as well in writing. But all of them ought to be given the same type
of instruction. The same opportunity to learn to write well. Because after all, I'll tell you something. I went to this through the school system. We didn't, and this is a speech I made before. Will you forgive me? It's the last bit. I'm going to make it one more time. The last time was with leveling. Now, this is a different subject. But I went through this school system, and we didn't have a gifted and talented program. Probably didn't have anybody gifted in the school at the time. I don't know. But I surely wasn't one of them. But I knew who the smart kids were. I knew who the intellectually powerful kids were. And I knew who the ones were who weren't, and I was among them who weren't. Now, I'll tell you something. Some of those kids who weren't labeled intellectually powerful did all right in this world. They learned to write, and through their writing did some very good things. They learned to speak and debate, did some very good things. Some of them are even accountants. They learned to count. But they didn't get a special program, and some of them really achieved quite a lot. I don't want to hold back any kids. I want kids that can do math better than anybody else. I want them to work with Mr. Watts and others at a higher level. I want kids in and out, but I don't want a program that says, this is a pull-out program. You take these kids, they're all out, they're all special. Invariably. I want what Mary Jo told us we were going to get when I voted for the five-year plan. We had a vote on that, whether to send it to the five-year plan. And I was assured, and Barbara, tell me if I'm correct on this. I was assured before I cast my vote that the plan in implementation would be moving things back in instead of keeping it out. And I relied on that representation. And I think I had a right to rely on what people told me that night. So I agree with most of this report, except for one thing. I want to see in the report, and if I were to stay on the school board, I would want to see in this report before we approved anything, sooner rather than later, the language that accommodates the assertions made to us that night. Let's tell us how you're going to start moving this back in the classroom. And so no one will feel threatened. I'll repeat what I said at the beginning. For those who are already in the program and whose parents are accustomed to having them in the pullout, try to work out something to accommodate them so that when they, after they get up through eighth grade, then we won't have to, you know, worry about that. But that's what I'm for. There's been a lot of talk over 6 years about gifted and talented, and I came a long way on this, and I came to the middle, and I don't see other people doing it. It is fine to say, this is recommendation number one. The school ensure that a consistently strong classroom curriculum be taught to all students. Everybody in the world agrees with that statement. You can't find a human being alive who doesn't agree with that. That's not the issue. Next. Who shall we start down there and just go?
Sure. Doesn't leave a heck of a lot to say. I had all these notes before you started. I can't add much to what Harold has said, and I've only been on the school board for a year. I thought all you people here tonight were because it was Harold's last meeting. I'm disappointed that you weren't here for his send-off. I guess I can't add anything, in all honesty, except that when you have, and I have a daughter who's in the third grade, who's going into the fourth grade next year, she struggled last week with tests. She came home frustrated because she was afraid that she didn't understand multiplication as well as she should. She was afraid that she didn't understand division as well as she should. And she knew that other kids had it in some parts of the school in the third grade. She felt that, you know, we walked on the beach one day and she said, you know, I'm in the dumb class, Dad. And I said, what do you mean you're in the dumb class? She said, well, other kids are being pulled out for these programs to be given extra help and extra work because they must be smarter than I am. I'm offended by that, in all honesty. And I think as you look at the program, just titling the program Challenge says to every kid who isn't in it that he's not, or he or she is not challenged. And I think that's something we really have to come to grips with.
I've been on this committee that has met all year, and there's been a lot of frustration. I think that in all the talking that we've done this year, you're right, an entire year has now gone by. And I would be unhappy to see another entire year go by sending it to another committee, and then another entire year go by giving it to somebody else to look at or to start to implement. Because I think that every year that goes by that we give a test and pick 10 kids and say, you guys are gifted and the rest are not, we're doing far more damage than we ever could by doing almost anything else. And from what I've heard tonight, I don't think that it's the challenge program per se that everybody loves so much as it is the curriculum that's part of that challenge program and the excellent teaching that goes on as part of that program. Why aren't we all asking for that for all the kids and not just for 10 each year? I don't think that it's been determined. I haven't heard it talked about as far as pullout, just where in the research that it says that in order for kids to be challenged and to talk with intellectual peers, that it has to happen one period a day, 5 days a week. I don't think that it has to not happen. I think certainly there's a time for it, but I think that the process that we go through now is an inappropriate one. Also, I haven't seen where it talks about at what age it's important for intellectual peers to talk together. What happens? In third grade, they're all talking together and they're doing very well and having a great time. What happens over the summer that suddenly, magically, they have to be pulled out for one period a day to talk with each other? I'm not sure that I see that correlation. And also, I think that it bothers me to talk about layers still, because we're still talking about cutoff points, you're in, you're not. That's not the kind of flexibility I would like to see. Instead of talking about layers of you're exceptionally gifted and you're the next layer and you're the layer below that, I'd like to see it go this way so that in all subject areas, kids can excel, whether it be for one unit of an entire program, whether it be for an entire year, whether it be across the board in all subject areas or however, but enough flexibility so that we're not identifying kids in layers and with the kind of labels that implies. Also, the consistency from school to school is an important issue for me. I think that in K through 3 right now, where they say, we're going to send people into the classroom, we're going to recognize that some kids need acceleration, enrichment, growth, horizontal growth, vertical growth, whatever, that's really important. And I don't ever say that we should just stick all kids in the classroom and forget about any of them. I don't think that that's fair either. But in K through 3, where they now have the program and policy in place that the kids stay in the classroom and work, we get them into 4 through 8, we have another policy in effect where we give the test and we pick. And once you're globally gifted, that's it. You're throughout your whole middle school education, you stay globally gifted. And as far as I'm concerned, there are very, very, very few in this world that are globally gifted. I think that's a term that has to be very carefully applied. And I'm not sure that I think it happens through, I know it doesn't happen through one test at the end of third grade. Then we get into the high school and we have the right to fail or right to succeed or however you want to say it. If somebody wants to try an AP class, they're welcome to try that. So we have three different, well, actually, I see it as two different kinds of things, where the middle school is an exception to the other two. And I think that somehow we have to find the consistency among all three schools. And I, for one, since we've talked about K through 5 quite a bit, I would like to hear Barbara Powers' view on this, because she's going to be the leader of K through 5.
Barbara, would you come up? You're now going to be cross-examined.
Gosh, I thought I might was maybe going to get off easy. No way. I caught up very late in the process with the Challenge Review Committee. In fact, a week ago yesterday, and felt it would have been helpful to hear the debate the entire year, but the way the reorganization came, I caught up at the tail end and shared with the committee some of the perspectives that I thought I could bring to it. I think Chris's suggestion that we start dealing with this with the K-5 team is really critical right now. If I could summarize what I said to the committee that day, and those of you for there, excuse me for just a minute, but my sense was with the committee that the discussions had been as intense as they are here tonight, very intense. And sitting in Chris's little office, it was fairly warm. And my comment was, in a situation like Challenge, we all bring really very different but very strong perceptions and perspectives to discussion. And it's very much based on our own personal experiences and perhaps the experiences of our children. And I knew the people in the room and what they represented, and I could see the very strong feelings they had for some of what was being debated, and the fact that committee wasn't coming to consensus was an indication of the strength of conviction. As a person thrown into this process toward the end, I shared with them that I was bringing three different perspectives to this discussion, and ones that had sort of shaped my own views of this process and where we needed to head. The first one being my experiences as an administrator and watching the philosophical stand we've taken at Pond Cove and our attempt to forge an identity for ourselves that made sense for all learners, and how we had really taken a lot of pride in that notion of accepting responsibility for wide-range learners and dealing with them within classroom. That a second perspective I brought was that of a teacher who has worked with extremely able children, and to know how very demanding that is, and how we ask an awful lot of teachers to deal with wide range of ability, so that recognition was certainly there on my part. And third of all, as a parent, differently than all the parents that have paraded before you tonight, a parent of a child who's really been solidly rejected by any program options in the middle school. Roundly rejected. So I said, for what it's worth, my comments have to do with what I bring to you too. So accept them for what they are. So I guess what I would share is that I have to agree with Jan in the case that you've given me a charge to try to pull together a K-5 school that makes some sense for learners. And right now, I'm having a little bit of difficulty with a major philosophical shift from the third to the fourth grade, as if something magical happens to children. We would not think to do between second and third grade to children what happens to them between third and fourth. And we're so soundly committed to respecting children's rights to excel and to have exposure to opportunities that it would bother me as an administrator to have to stand in front of a large group and justify the selection process. And that's simply the way I feel. Second of all, as a teacher, I spoke to the fact that, yes, you can talk about teacher resources and you can talk about the different strengths teachers bring, and certainly that's true. And certainly there's no magic answer to how to deal with the different strengths teachers bring to their classrooms. But I would have given my eye teeth when I was dealing with some real exceptionally able kids to have resource people available to me, to have someone to consult with, to have a math coordinator in place, which we will have next year. To have the curriculum resource person in the person of Claire Ruthenberg we have available to us this year would have made an enormous difference to me. And I would have readily invited her into my classroom and consulted with her in terms of appropriate program options, not only for the kids I felt were emerging from my own curriculum and needed that, but to possibly invite and be inclusive of other kids who were showing some interest in that particular area. to me, that feels particularly fine and solid and a way to deal with exceptionally able kids, especially when they are still children. The notion of labeling is a peeve of mine. I'll admit that, too. Michael spoke at committee to the fact that achievement data shows that 40% to 70% of what a child is able to achieve in his lifetime is dependent on their self-concept, and that, in fact, the very process of labeling and the empowerment that that gives to children can't be overstated. It's simply very powerful. And I think we have to be very careful about signals children are getting when they're 9 and 10 years old. Thirdly, as a parent, I've already spoken to that. I've watched and had to support tears. I've had to support resignation that I just must not be as good as my best friend. And major peer fallout from the chance of a fourth grader having to cope with the fact that she's been told she's that much more able than her friends, and watching some real friendships dissolve over a child's inability to deal with that. I'm not saying that's true for all children at all, but if everybody else is going to speak personally, I will speak personally. I had to do a lot of shoring up of confidence and have continued to have to. So it's what I bring to this arena is my own series of experiences, and I would be the first to acknowledge that I don't have a lot of ready answers. But I think the one important question with all of this is, are we doing the best we can now? And I'd have to say no. And I'd really like for us to look seriously at what we do and consider all options, rule out none, but give it a much more solid look with a full K-5 team involvement than we have today.
Do you have any other questions? Anybody have any questions about? Did you have a question, Tara? You're next, kid.
My turn. I don't have any answers either, and I've appreciated everything that's been said tonight. I'm looking at the three starred items here that seem to have caused the lack of consensus, and apparently one of the issues is whether the program should be in the classroom or a pull-out program. And I think the direction that we're going in the elementary school, which is a whole language program, a whole math program, which says to me, we individualize in these subjects, we can take care of all the needs of the students that we have. We don't need to leave people in kindergarten an extra year. We need to let them go with their peers, their age group, and we will satisfy the needs that they have. I believe that means that they also can handle the challenge part of it too, at least to some extent. They're willing to try that. So I think we're moving toward a program that to some extent can satisfy the needs of all students within the classroom, especially with some resource people who can come in. Now, can that happen next year? I don't know the answer to that. I would suspect if you asked the 5 fourth grade teachers, can you handle challenge within your classroom, maybe 2 would say yes and 3 would say no. And then what do you do? Do you take the students that you think need individual help and put them in one of those two classrooms? If so, then what you've done is put all your challenge people together all day long, every day. And that bothers me. So I feel like we need to have the commitment of everyone saying, I've been trained, I'm comfortable with this, I can handle this. And I think all this training we're having, that we should be coming to that, at least through fifth grade, and I don't know where whole language will go from fifth grade. I think we should be coming to the point where the teachers, with help from outside, a resource person, can handle the needs of their students within the classroom. I also think in the identification process, we need to start zeroing in on different strands. I don't think these children really are universally gifted. I think they might be very good in language arts. I think they might be very good in math. I think they might be very good in fine arts. I would be very surprised if we had very many students who are very strong in all three of those areas. And I think we've got innovative enough staff that we can come up with some kind of testing that says, through observation, whatever, this child has leapfrogged 3 years in math and they've got to have some special help. Or this child is reading the encyclopedia from cover to cover and quoting, and I can't handle it. But there may be a few in the system that excel in all areas, but I think that would be very unusual. I guess that's all I have to say. I do believe, and this hasn't been said, but I do believe there are students who are very, very bright and somehow fall through the cracks. They never say a word in class. You think that they're not very intellectually gifted. And then we were given some material in the fall that showed the SAT scores of the class that graduated last year. And the highest SAT scores were by a student who was, I think, 85th in the class. And I kept thinking, this is very strange. So, this child has been lost somewhere in the system. And I don't know the answer to that. But I don't think that challenge opportunities for a small percentage of students is a reward. It's really a need that they have. And I have no answers. And I have to listen, and I have to understand what the faculty who are going to have to implement this program think that they can do. And I don't know the answers to that tonight, because I have not heard from all of them. But that's what I have to say.
Thank you, Loretta. Peter?
I think to some extent I'm reminded of what a politician said during one of the conventions last summer. Everything's been said, but not everybody said it. So I'm going to leap over, having listened to the four other members of the board, some of the philosophical considerations. And besides, I spoke or asked a lot of questions in the beginning. And take us to what I think is a practical level of what are we going to do? What is going to be the sense of the board? What instruction, if any, are we going to give? And I think there are at least two areas, maybe three. Are we going to do third grade testing? That's number one.
Oh.
Number two, are we going to keep the fifth grade as it is, or are we going to try to build in some of the fluidity and dynamics that some of us talked about earlier? Is it too late to do that? Are the teachers ready? Can you operate a transition program in the fifth grade? And finally, when are we going to start looking at the gifted and talented program in the context of the true middle school, which, as I indicated earlier in my question to Chris, the gifted and talented program, as we have it now, clearly doesn't fit with the literature on the true middle school. Now, perhaps we have more time for that. I suspect we do, so that the first two points are the ones that we probably ought to try to achieve some consensus on tonight.
What was the first question?
What do we do about third grade? Are we going to put the kids through the rigorous...
First thing, I suggest we have it next year, third grade.
Okay, that's settled out. Everybody in agreement? Are we going to do the third grade testing? I'm beginning to talk in shorthand due to the lateness of the hour.
Down. Well, anybody have any comments on that?
From us? Yeah, I do. Oh. Go ahead.
Go ahead, Mike.
This, of course, is a complex matter. Deals with not just the education for gifted and talented children, but it also deals greatly with the matter of an evolving and developing curriculum, which I happen to think drives any conversation or dialogue or debate about the education of our kids. The matter of the third grade specifically, Peter, is going to be the sole topic of next Tuesday's meeting with the review team, in order to come to some, we hope, resolution of that, and then we'll articulate that on to the superintendent, the board, and parents.
I do not have a third grade child. Make that clear.
I also would just like to point out, while I have the podium, Harold, that virtually everything that has been addressed here this evening has a place in this process. We will continue to dialogue and debate some of these matters, but just about everything that's been asked for, talked about, or mentioned this evening has a place in the process. And so when we come back to the board a little bit later, I think you will see a number of components of resolution in some proposed models that we'll be discussing through the month of May and probably into June that will in fact address a huge number of these issues, and in fact will include programming for all kids as well as those children who ride out through the curriculum.
Wayne, I think I appreciate what you said. I think what Peter is saying is what about the policy issue of whether there'll be testing or not? And I think he's saying that he'll decide, he and his group will decide next week, and they'll let you know.
Oh, thank you.
Mr. Chairman, that isn't what he said. He said the group would recommend to the superintendent what they ought to do. Yeah. The superintendent would take it to the board.
On testing.
I thought that's what you said.
On the assessment of children, I hesitate to just sort of categorize it by testing. I just caution you to, in the assessment of children. Yes.
All right, yeah. All right. Peter, that issue's coming back to the board. Next question.
But I would hope that on the committee it will now include, as part of the committee, the elementary people that are involved, the curriculum coordinator, and not just be solely the original committee.
As I'm sure you remember, Jen, that committee has already been expanded by Barbara and Michael Efron. We also, if I, help me, Chris, with this, I believe Chris has extended an invitation to appear for also Sue Welch and Claire Ruthenberg. Claire, who is the consultant coordinator at the Pond Cove system.
I just wanted to make it clear, though, that they would be part of the committee and not just guests, and what their recommendations are would also be part of. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Is that agreed?
That's accurate.
All right. So they'll be participating members.
Yes, they will.
Of this recommending body.
Sure.
And the recommendation will be made to the superintendent, who will communicate it. To
the
us?
Board.
Who makes the decision ultimately?
The board. Okay. Policy.
Policy.
Put that in the minutes.
And the superintendent will recommend what the board should do.
Do we have that much time to go through that process?
They meet next Tuesday?
Yes.
They have a June meeting. We'll
Peter,
that.
You can even have a special meeting of the board if you want. It wouldn't take very long, and all you have to do is notice it, I think.
Well,
5-6 days.
And I would suggest that we look at a special session if, in fact, there are going to be changes that have to be made in the fourth grade next year. A month when school's in session and the teachers are still around and whatever, it would be invaluable if there are major changes that are going to be made to the program between now and September, that it be done at a special meeting and not wait till the next meeting of the school board.
If the committee recommends any major changes, Chairman, I'll call the chairman of the board, who's going to be chairman of the board for a while, or the new chairman, whoever that is, and do it immediately. If there are no changes and the superintendent agrees with everything in the committee, I'll convey that to you in a memo. That there are no changes.
No changes to what?
In other words, if there's not to be any testing, if the committee doesn't recommend any testing,
yes,
I'll convey that to you and also to the chairman to see if he wants a meeting to determine anything about that.
But if there, he's saying, but if there is going to be testing, you'll have a memo in your packet for the next school board meeting.
If they were out, I will have what they recommend and what the superintendent recommends, and then the board, and then if you want a meeting,
I tell you what, Darryl, this is next week.
why don't you, you don't need more than 24 hours or so to 48 hours to mull over.
I need 10 minutes.
10 minutes.
To mull over a recommendation, and I've talked with these people ad infinitum. And
why don't you
almost know what the recommendation is.
All right. After you have completed your 10 minutes of deliberation, would you get a memorandum out to the board members?
Happy to. And if you deem we need a meeting, I'd be happy to have.
Next question, Peter. What was the second one?
Well, I think the second question is probably the same committee. I think it depends to a certain extent on what the decision is and the recommendation is on the third grade. And that is, what do you do about the fifth grade? I choose the fifth grade because the fifth grade is still under the, or will be in that year, under Barbara Powers. There are students that are in the fifth grade, or in the fourth grade program, who will be in the fifth grade program. Will it simply be kept as it is, or will some changes be made in it? And that's only a question. It's not a view.
Peter, that is another point that's somewhat of a corollary to the first one, what will happen to the entering fourth grade. It would appear at this point that we're not proposing and probably won't propose any change for next year's fifth grade, with the possible exception of beginning to attempt some consultation collaboration with classroom teachers, and that would be somewhat of an expansion of the program, but not a deletion of anything. That's my guess, and I don't want to usurp the decision of that committee, but to this point there has not been any solid positions on changing the fifth grade next year.
How do you feel about that? You wouldn't have asked the question unless you had some views.
Well, I was trying to reduce our philosophical discussions to some practical, you know, to see how the decision making would go. I personally felt that a lot of people got up and spoke in favor of the expansion of the program. Is the board going to, you know, make a motion tonight, agree that that's a direction we want this committee to go in? I mean, we have the three starred items here. Are we going to try to resolve those tonight by saying that we've listened to everybody's testimony, we've thought about it ourselves, and we now feel X, Y, and Z?
Well, I wanted to at the outset, what I said that I would hope we would do was to respond to these recommendations, going back to the committee. Ultimately, you've got to come up with something that is going to get three votes on this board. Ultimately, you want five. I agree you ought to have five. But if worse comes to worse, you got to have at least three. So I think now you have five people that have the same concerns and generally the same comments. What I think, Peter, and I don't even know whether there are five who agree with this, but what, in terms of specifics, I would hope the board would say to the superintendent, look, recommendation number two, for instance, the challenge program, continue to provide time for students to meet with intellectual peers, be modified, not eliminated. That it be done in the context of what Mary Jo described as moving things back into the classroom. And that these recommendations be redone to reflect what Mary Jo told us.
But would we really want that if it meant that all the kids who were identified as challenged students be in the same classroom?
No.
Oh, Mary Jo's here.
So, yeah, we'd like you to, because I remember what you said before.
I didn't see you back there.
I think when we spoke last year and when we discussed the five-year plan, I think the part that you're thinking of, Harold, is that we discussed looking at challenge and looking particularly at the curriculum of challenge. And then as part of our curriculum process, which was also part of the plan to look at the entire curriculum of the school system, that we would look at those components of challenge and say, are some of these also appropriate for other children? And to systematically work at folding those into the classroom where they were appropriate. And we had begun that process by, for example, a couple years ago, looking at the component that was the junior grade books piece. And we said, indeed, this is not a program that should be exclusively for the 10 children who are in challenge. This is a program that could benefit all students. And therefore, in the process of about, I think, 2 to 3 years, we've been able to train all the classroom teachers now from K to, I don't know, I think all the way up to 7 or 8, yeah, to do the junior grade books program. And now there is a junior grade books program for all kids, which is indeed an enrichment and a, you know, something that has helped them to have a better language arts program. And we still have the challenge program in junior grade books, which operates at, again, another level, if you will. For example, in the fourth grade, where the junior grade books program in the classroom is primarily discussion, in the fourth grade in challenge, it's also an essay, where they will also be discussing their ideas in writing. So there's still a little bit of, there's differentiation for students, but we're not ignoring the fact that that is a very good program, and it belongs, it should be available for all kids. Another one that I would say we're working on, I forget to breathe sometimes when I'm up with this, especially with this. I have to breathe now, okay. Another one we're working on, I would say, in math, for example, is as we look at a whole new approach to math, one thing that has been sort of an exclusive area of challenge has been logic. You know, that there's been a kind of formal program in logic that's gone through the 4th through 8th grade curriculum and challenge. And what will probably happen is, as we work with Rachel and we actually delineate those aspects of math that we're going to be giving another look at, those things are going to come out and be available to other children, you know, on a regular basis as part of the whole curriculum. However, there will be still students who learn logic much more rapidly, much earlier, and we shall still have to provide for those students. Did that help clarify?
Yes, it did. Thank you.
Okay.
Appreciate that, Mary Jo. What I would suggest, Peter, this is what I want to do, and I don't know whether anybody else wants to do it. I would like to instruct the superintendent to get back to the administrators in the committee and say, we generally like the recommendations of the challenge review team for May 1989, except that we would like them to give us recommendations as to how we make the program more flexible, bring more of the instruction back into the classroom. Now that's what I would like the superintendent to do, and then from that, and we would instruct then the superintendent to get back to us at the earliest possible time with those recommendations from this committee as to how that can be achieved.
And the assessment too.
And to change the assessment process in a way that permits there to be continuing assessment through successive years to accommodate the phenomenon of changing development patterns. Okay, You have that down, Colonel?
Phenomenon of...
Changing
developmental patterns.
That's it.
So you're saying that you would assess them after third grade, the way they've been assessed, but then after fourth grade, you would assess all the people again?
Well, I don't know whether they...
I know what I want to see. I want to see a program. I'm sure that people out there are smart enough to figure out how to do it. I'm not. A program that would permit us to continue to assess these people so that we don't select people in third grade...
For 5 years.
For 5 years and say, that's it. And I understand that there's... I understand that some come in and some go out.
I'd still be interested in seeing those numbers, incidentally.
So that's what I'd like to see. Now, what I want to find out is whether anyone else wants you to do that. If they do, that's the board's instruction to the superintendent.
But you see, I don't know if we're all in favor of assessing at third grade. I'm not.
All right. Let's discuss that for a minute.
If you may, I?
Yeah.
If you maintain the K-3 program and you identify youngsters where the teacher wants some help with a consultant, you're going to make some kind of assessment. That doesn't mean you have to give a series of tests.
I'm talking about the assessment that's in place right now.
Then I'm using the word very broadly. If you identify somebody who needs help in the classroom, that's an assessment.
Right, yeah.
But you're talking about the kind of assessment we're doing now that's...
IQ tests or whatever.
It draws a distinct line at the end of third grade that says...
Okay.
Yeah, and that is... how many hours is it? Is it 6 hours?
Four.
All right, so what are you... how would you amend my instruction?
The present assessment program. In other words,
to look at the present assessment program with an open mind, to not say, you know, we're going to continue to assess the way we have, but particularly with the K-5 pattern, look at that and then look at how assessments should be done for 6, 7, 8, using the middle school concept, if that's the way we're headed.
Do you understand?
I do.
All right, so now, what if we were to agree on this instruction to you, how would you understand the instruction? I'm not trying. I want to get it straight because
you want all of the points.
Before you became superintendent, sometimes we didn't get it straight.
We want the future children programs to be consistent with what the 5-year plan stated.
Here's let me go over it again.
Now, I have this verbatim on my web.
Okay.
And between us, I'm quite certain we can capture what you people had said tonight.
All right. Okay.
And if you have no more to say, I'd like to just say one thing that concerns me to no end.
What's
that? And it's for the community and for the committee and the board. And I'm going to preface this with one thing. As the ex-principal of the Gifted School for Arts and Science in Connecticut, we have developed in this community, I've noticed for 3 years, a myopic view that there's only one way to treat talented kids. And we haven't discussed what everybody in the world is doing, like mentors, and some kids being pulled out, and tutors, and 3 years of high school, and acceleration. We're shortchanging these kids on ways to help them. And we've concentrated on this program for 10 since I've been here for 3 years. We have a youngster that should be going to college and he's in the 9th grade. And the high school can't provide for him. And there are a few others, I'm certain, that need some help. Now, I would hope that the committee would start looking at the wide variety of ways to help these youngsters within the context of what the board has prescribed. I'll return to you after I meet with the committee. And I think the superintendent will be on the committee for the remaining portion of the year, so he's very close to what's happening.
That would be helpful to the board, I think, just to have that.
Then I have some real feeling for who's invested and what we're invested about and why.
Let me start down here and
find out whether you think we're on the right track with this instruction of the superintendent.
I do.
We'll put this together tomorrow in the morning.
I'm confused, but that's all right. I'm confused, but please don't explain it to me.
Now, I'm intrigued by that. I am not confused, but if Loretta's confused, that makes me wonder whether or not I ought to be confused.
So do you agree with those instructions?
I do.
So it's...
Do you want me to try and read this, please?
Yes.
Harold said, let's instruct the superintendent to get back to the administrators and say that we generally like the recommendation of the challenge review team for May 1989, except we would like them to give us a recommendation as to how we make the program more flexible and bring instruction into the classroom.
To bring the program more into the regular classroom.
Make the program more flexible.
Make it more flexible and bring the ways to bring the program back into the classroom.
All right.
And then you got the other one was the assessment.
Yeah, so you can get back to school as possible time to change the assessment. The assessment process in a way that permits and to be continuing assessments to accommodate the phenomenon of changing developmental patterns.
Right. Yeah.
All right. I'm sorry, Barbara, but I was emphatic on the way we would do this. It's the only way it can be done and not have this go all night long. At least four out of the five, and one considering it.
I understand. Yeah. Yes, that's fine to consider that.
So that's the response to the report.
Thank you.
All right. Moving on. We're now in the regular items. Citizen discussion of other items not on the agenda. Are there any citizen discussion of other items not on the agenda? If not, we move on to the next item. Approval of the minutes of the regular meeting held on April 11, 1989. Members of the board have the minutes of the meeting. You've reviewed them. Any modifications? If not, I'll entertain a motion to approve them.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Aye. All opposed? That's a vote. Next is the business manager's report. You all have a copy of the business manager's report. You've all had an opportunity to review it. Do you have any questions of D about his business manager's report?
Excellent report, D.
Fine report.
Everybody likes the report? All right, the business manager's report is approved. The next item is consideration of retirements. We have three retirements: Clifford McWinney, industrial arts teacher at the high school; Liz Barton, first grade teacher at Pond Cove School; Bruce Emmons, mathematics teacher at the high school. Mr. Superintendent, do you have any comments?
No, except that I would hope you'd accept these resignations with regret.
All right. The three retirements. Is there a motion? Accept them.
I have to say a word.
Yes.
I can't let this go without.
Okay,
I
think
you
should.
We can't hurry through this. I wish Mr. Emmons well. I have been told that he is leaving education and going into another occupation, and I certainly wish him well. Liz Barton is a beloved first grade teacher, and we just can't go on to another item without thanking her for her years of service to the school system. I talked with a mother yesterday who had had three children who had had Ms. Barton and has a fourth child coming through and can't believe that this child could enter first grade and not have had Ms. Barton as the first grade teacher. So we wish her well. And Mr. McQuinney is an institution at the high school in the finest sense of the word. He's meant so much to those students. I wish I knew probably the number of budding architects whose occupations were decided and formed by their relationship with him and the quality of his time and service that he gave to the young people. And I feel like we're losing some very, very fine educators.
Thank you. I endorse what you said. You're absolutely right. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
All in favor? Signify. All opposed?
Next one, I'm extremely
pleased.
Excuse me.
The one I skipped over one, which was the budget cuts. We have been instructed by the town council to make $75,000 reduction in the school budget for next year. The school board has had a workshop session to discuss some of these budget reductions. Darrell, do you want to explain them?
Primarily, they're in equipment and a half a teacher at the high school in the English department. I should mention to the board, last night the town council accepted our portable for $150,000, and they also accepted the bond of $600,000.
That item does not require a vote at this meeting, I don't believe. We've been through the retirements. You have a nomination to make, Darrell?
Yes, I'm very pleased. We have a very excellent candidate for the assistant elementary principal in Nancy Hutton. Her enclosed her vita. She's been on leave of absence this year and worked all over the state. She brings a very strong background in curriculum and will work closely with Barbara and Michael. I'm very pleased that she's coming with us.
Are we confirmed? Are we supposed to?
I would hope you'd vote.
Vote on that. We certainly endorse your views of Nancy's ability, and very pleased that she has agreed to do this. I think it'd make a big difference to the entire system. She's a very talented person.
I move that we accept the nomination of Nancy Hutton as the assistant principal of Pond Cove School.
Is there a second? All in favor? Opposed? Another nomination?
French teacher for grades 4 through 8, for 89-90, and her vita's attached, and I'm very pleased, a very young person, you'll note magna cum laude, French major, should fit right in nicely with that department.
Well, I just wanted to say I was fortunate enough to sit on the interview committee with that individual, and I'm very pleased that she's accepted our invitation to join the school. I think we have a fine teacher, and I look forward to her working with her.
Great. Is there a motion?
I move that we
second.
All in favor? Vote. Any new business to be brought before the school board? Any old business to be brought before the school board? Any further comments by board members?
None, other than I will add my regrets that you'll be no longer gracing the stage here with us at least once a month. I think the town loses a brilliant legal mind at a very nominal cost on the school board and probably keeps our legal fees down to a great degree. And unfortunately, I don't think we have any lawyers on the board anymore, so you don't mind if we call you every once in a while for a brief opinion.
Oh, no, I always like to.
But I stress the brief, if I can do that.
That I can't do.
I personally will miss you, and I look forward to whatever insights that you have, and I hope you'll continue to contribute in some way.
Thank you very much, John. Very nice. I appreciate it. If there's nothing else, Wayne?
I debated, Harold, whether I should speak to this, but I believe I should. I'm a career special educator, and I have spent some 23 years with handicapped children and their families. And when I came here, I spoke briefly with my predecessor, Donna Morley, and asked for a brief description of the school board so that I might have a better understanding of the people that I would be presenting the needs of handicapped children to. And when Donna came to Harold Patius, she said he is a very bright man, who is gifted in his questioning strategies, and you should know what you're doing before you step up to request program changes or additions for children, and that his searching questions will make you think about a very important question when we educate children, and that is why. And I guess on behalf of my predecessor and my brief experience with you, I'd like to say on behalf of hundreds of kids that have obviously come before you in terms of decision making over the years in your tenure on that dais, thanks for caring about those kids and standing by them and for them. And I'm going to miss you too.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate that. Thank you. I do care about them all a lot, and I appreciate your words, and it's getting to the point where I'm sorry I can't retire next month, too.